Alright, we're back.
Hey, what's going on, man?
Not much, man. Took a few weeks off.
I think
you need to apologize to the fans, though, because we said we were going to roll right into this, and we took a little time off.
Look, it happens.
Yeah.
I think just stuff got kind of weird with, like, I had a bunch of shows in a row.
Yeah.
And that, I got exhausted. I got fatigued, man. I had a Towson show. They had a panel about race, and then I had something near DC, and then just doing stand up that much.
Yeah.
And it's good. Don't get me wrong. I love it. Right. But it gets exhausting. Then the other podcast, two podcast episodes every time.
Right. And I didn't know y'all do two every time.
We do two every time.
Okay.
We two pocket. We just get a bunch of clip and then put them out later. So, so how have you been, man?
Pretty good, man. Been doing a lot of stuff behind the scenes, you know, just securing some things up as far as the podcast go. The announcement that we made for the Best of 2016 episode, as far as the Rock and Lipson podcast, that's actually going to be on episode 93. Our promo is going to be on that one. And then on 95, our actual segment, the 5-minute segment that we did, it's going to be on that episode.
You mean the magic? The magic that we fucking did?
Yeah.
That was dope, man. I really enjoyed that.
I definitely can't wait for y'all to hear it. So I think like in the next week or two, that should be out.
Cool.
I think they're on like episode 91 or 92 right now. So.
Designs. Tell me about designs. How's it been going?
Actually, I designed some merch for the podcast, so
yeah,
we got some things coming up. So probably by the time we can officially announce the events, we'll be able to announce the merch for it. So far, I can talk about this date for Baltimore County Libraries. We actually been asked to do a panel for them. Well, actually, our own event.
We should have some guests.
I was trying to figure out what we should do for it. So it's going to be the second week of July. We have to pick the official date. So between the 10th and the 13th, we'll discuss that after this. We'll have a show. It'll be at, I believe, the Woodlawn Public Library branch.
Mm-hmm.
We'll get an hour, you know, pretty much just to talk about how we started the podcast, how we got our business going, and then we'll have an open Q&A after that. But yeah, got some other things going on, but I think that's everything that we can officially announce at the moment.
Cool. I have my flyers on my Instagram. My cousin and I put out a song. So my cousin and I formed a group called Catch the Fade. It's just us rhyming. So I think that the part of the creative process in your life is you should never feel limited to anything. I do literally everything that comes in my head.
Yeah.
So stand up, podcasting, acting, whatever comes
get
to
that creative energy out.
Yeah,
that's what's
creative
important.
Energy out. And then getting a stamp on my passport. I feel bad that I'm leaving and we can't record another one before. We should try to record something before I leave.
Well, yeah.
Let's try to record something. So I'm going to London on the 18th and catching the train to Paris that following Tuesday and going to Disneyland Paris.
Wow.
Yo, when I say that it's cheaper for... Yo, listeners, it's cheaper for you to go to London than it is for you to go to Florida if you make the right moves. If you just do it in advance.
Yeah.
I'm just saying. My plane ticket is cheaper than it was for me to fly to Florida. So, me and my girl together going to London round trip is $300. $350.
The tickets.
I'm just saying.
Both of your tickets.
Both of our tickets. Round trip. I'm just saying. We flew through Iceland through Wild Airlines.
Right.
Disney Paris has a promotion going on because it's off season. $53 for our tickets, nigga. Do you hear me? $53 for us to get into the park.
Yeah.
I'm just you gotta get me.
You gotta hustle.
You know you gotta have a cheap friend.
Yeah.
A cheap traveler, because I have a friend. I had a friend who happens to be white. I don't like to bring up race all the time, but I noticed that he traveled a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So I started talking to him, and I realized that he just is a smart traveler, man.
Yeah. As far as what I do for traveling, I have a whole bunch of different apps. Skyscanner is really good.
Oh, yeah, Skyscanner.
You can go in there. You can pretty much search. It'll search, I believe, all North American airlines and websites as far as getting tickets, because... Where did I go? I had to go to Atlanta, and where I booked it from was actually like a Canadian site that they gave me, and got the tickets real cheap. As far as housing, Airbnb is really good.
Airbnb is incredible.
You don't want to stay in a hotel, especially when you go into foreign countries. Sometimes the Airbnbs are a lot bigger and a lot better than actually staying in a hotel, and cheaper. So
yeah. And you can actually live, like, I like to get pampered sometimes, but I think when we go to London, we're gonna just go to the market and cook ourselves.
Okay.
For some of the days, and then, like, so for breakfast, we're probably going to cook, and then we're just going to go out. We're going to go to, like, Brixton. I want to be around some black people. I want to get some soul food.
Word.
I have a friend that's there, so it's going to be dope. So all I'm saying is you can travel for very cheap, bro. I'm telling you. Like, a lot of people feel like when I say things like London, it's like, oh, you going to London? It is. We're saving $500-$600 in comparison to when we went to, like, the Wizarding World of Harry Potter, which I loved, by the way. No disrespect. Yeah. I loved it. But it's cool. It's cool. Talk to people about stuff, man. Find out how they travel. It might not be as expensive
as
you
think. I need to get over there because I actually have access to the Streetwear Master Studio. Since I'm an alum of that program, they give me free access to use their studio. So if I ever go over there and want to do a photo shoot.
That's dope.
Yeah. I just have
that's incredible, man.
Submit the form for it. Then the other thing about travel, Lyft.
Lyft?
Yes. We actually have a promo code for that. So if you don't use Lyft yet, I know a lot of people are switching to it right now from everything that's been going on with Uber.
People choosing sides right now.
Yeah. So just the name of the podcast, branded BRNDD. If you want to sign up, I believe you get $50 free credit.
Yeah.
Drivers, you also get money after you do your first initial rides, and you guys be good to go.
Yeah.
But let's get into the episode, right?
Cool. Yeah, yeah. All right.
So... today, our guest is Brian from Creative Culture. He has some unique products. We're going to let him talk about what he does a little bit.
What's up, what's up, what's up, man? What's good? Thanks for having me.
No problem.
So, I go by the name of Brian, a.k.a. the Beard Baron, a.k.a. Mr. Fox 45, a.k.a. Mr. Fox 43, a.k.a. Mr. Don't Touch My Beard, all of that. So, yeah, man, it's just been a fun time, 7 months in.
That's what's up, man.
Yep. That's dope, man.
So, Creative Culture Lifestyle is basically the culture and lifestyle of the bearded man.
Oh, wow.
So, one of the slogans I run with is create the culture, and it's a lifestyle. So, those two combined give you what I have created. And so, the Creative Culture Lifestyle is what we're doing right now, just podcasts, you know, vibing.
Right.
Creative Culture Lifestyle is, you know, smoking a cigar, enjoying a good bourbon.
So,
you know, it could be, you know, your favorite craft beer, whatever, you know, going to a nice spot and just relaxing. It's you creating the culture and the lifestyle that you want. But what I say is, as a bearded man, all of that incorporates the beard lifestyle, because having a beard is now is cool. But before it used to be, you know, passe, or, you know, it was like, oh, he has facial hair, he's unkempt, he can't work here.
Right.
So now it's a movement, you know, the beard movement is big. I know I felt more comfortable at work wearing my beard when a lot of white guys started wearing their beards.
Okay.
Because, you know, it's like when you're the first, it's like, oh, you know, but, you know, I always wore my beard low.
Right.
But it's like once I got to a point where I was like, okay, I'm going to just let it grow out. You know, that was based on the fact that I could look over and see, you know, Tom with his Wolfman beard, and it wasn't November. So it made you feel like, okay, if he can do it, I can do it.
Right,
if they tap me on my shoulder and tell me cut mine, I'm going to go ask him why they ain't tell him. So, you know, that's just where we at right now. But, I mean, the movement is crazy. My thing is I try to come at it with my own spin. You know, like you said, not to bring up race, but it's a lot of... white guys who had beard companies for a long time.
Right.
But the difference with my product is I truly cater to African-American hair because we have different hair.
Exactly. Right.
So it's more curly, and a lot of the beard oils don't work for us.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so without hair being more curly and everything like that, we have a shea butter with coconut oil, olive oil, and jojoba oil, all different oils that add to growth, add for maintenance, you know, just to keep your beard soft. And then we do it with a fragrance. So we have sandalwood, frankincense and myrrh, and unscented. So truly, it just gives you that good smell, but also keeps your beard moisturized, a nice sheen, not too shiny, not like how the oils can kind of be too much.
Okay.
And it also helps your skin where, you know, the coconut oil and different things like that, and the shea, all of that strengthen your hairs. And then, you know, we had the shampoo, the soap, wood combs, wood picks, you know, the brushes. So it's just adding products to go along with that.
Yeah.
I've been in marketing and sales for, you know, 20 years, you know, dating back to my first sales job selling credit cards at NBNA while I was in college. So, you know, I was like, people was dropping out of that job in 1 week. Like, I just don't want to be on the phones dialing. I mean, that was when we used to have to manually dial.
Where?
You know, didn't have the computer to call.
Yeah, just
you know,
right. going through
you,
and just.
You buying numbers, but yeah. they was giving money on the floor, like, you know, $7 for every sale.
Mm-hmm.
Say, what? Say what? You give cash? I'm a college student?
Right.
Like, you know, I mean, that's my bus fare for the next 3 days.
Yeah,
like,
right.
$7 a sale. So I would be like, okay, if I call 100 people and I get 5 sales, then I need to call another 100 people. So I looked at it like a numbers game.
Yeah.
Whereas a lot of people was dropping out. And for me, it was like, this is what I want to do. I want to be in sales.
Word.
So, you know, from that time to internships to everything, I was in sales. And, you know, from the day I graduated Morgan State, I've been in pharmaceutical sales for 15 years.
I went to Morgan, too.
Yeah. I see your wrist.
Yeah.
So I've been doing 15 years in sales. And it directly correlates to what I do every day, you know, because the whole beard thing is not really like people are like, oh, when did you become such a beardologist or whatever? And it's like, that's not the gift. The gift is the ability to connect with people and sell them something that they have a need for, but give them like the true service. So a lot of times when people say, oh, you know, black owned businesses, oh, I don't support black owned businesses. They, you know, this, that, I'm like, that's bullshit.
Right.
You know what I mean? So at the end of the day, I'm here to show people that I'm going to run my company just like Pfizer ran their company when I worked for them. So I take the things that I learned out, you know, in the field under certain managers and different people. And it's a lot of times I give stuff free away from just a small mistake I made.
Word.
Because that's customer service. Yeah. And that's how you keep people coming back, you know. So, I mean, I'm loving it, man. It's been a great ride. It's fun, you know.
Yeah, and that's kind of like the reason I wanted to bring you on, because I met you at Angel Park when you were, you know, displaying your stuff there and, you know, just meeting people, telling people about your product. I thought it was unique because you don't meet a lot of African Americans with their own care products, you know, whether it's hair care or facial care, and like to have natural products. That's a lot of what we need to, you know, make sure we take care of ourselves, because we have, you know, different skin, different hair, and just your whole presentation, you had a real professional way of, you know, talking to people and interacting with people, and you don't get that from just people in general when they're presenting their business. So I appreciated that. So you said you always had, you know, a thing for sales. Was that something that you had as a child, or?
I mean, it dates back to even like high school.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I look back, I was in high school selling DJ Lil Mike mixtapes. B side and A side.
Word.
Off at Malacca. That was back when Lil Mike used to get on at 4 a.m. over at 88.9, and he was just trying to get his name up.
Right.
So, I mean, he went to City, I went to Poly, but, you know, I never forget that Iaconelli was on the B side and Hit 'Em Up was on the A side. And
wow.
I sold more of them tapes than I sold probably the whole time I was in high school, just because those two songs was on there.
Yeah.
So it was like Hit 'Em Up was just a classic, and then Iaconelli was just like, you know, are these chicks really ready for this in high school? But it was just like, you know, people was at my locker. Like, I come to school like 2 weeks later and people at my locker like, yo, you got that joint? And I'm like, yo, yeah, I got that. You know what I mean? And then it was like, you know, I remember early 96, like Reasonable Doubt, Jay-Z and Big was on that, you know, just like, rest in peace, Big. Like, you know, March 9th.
20th anniversary of that, ironically.
Yeah, so looking back on it, that's the time when I was in high school. And, you know, just thinking of that whole era,
yeah.
But just like selling the tapes out the locker, that gives me that. I get excited about that because that's like when I think back to my first hustle.
Yeah,
you know,
right,
what I mean?
Right.
I was in college selling white tees. I was in college selling t-shirts with the middle finger on it. That this one graphic, my graphic designer who works with me now,
okay,
he made this like abstract t-shirt, and it's from afar you can't see it's the middle finger, but up close you see it is. But it was just like an abstract, cool design, and he made a bunch of t-shirts that we would sell. In college, and you know, I took my refund check and bought like 300 to 600 white tees at like $2 a pop, and I was like, my first experience, like, okay, well,
you know, just go to the mall and blow it, and just buy whatever you wanted.
And I was like, I'm gonna take this money and I'm gonna flip it. You know what I mean? And that was like, for me, a lot of dudes around me was like trying to hustle, trying to be in the drug game, trying to be and stuff. And I just always looked at everything from a risk reward standpoint, like.
Word.
you know, I'm going to risk all of this for how much? Oh, no, that's not enough money for me to get jammed up because I'm going to make money one day. So, like, when I came out of college.
And that was that time a lot of laws came in where you was getting crazy years for whatever you were selling.
Yeah, but it just was just like, you know, not even the years and the time. It's just more like watching your back. One thing I always learned young from being around people was like, well, you ain't doing nothing. Like, you ain't got to watch your back. Yeah, so a lot of times, the only time I was looking over my shoulder was to hope I ain't get stuck up or something like that. But it was never like I had enemies. And I go somewhere and I'm in the club and I'm looking around like, you know, it's like, that's the part of life where I always felt free. Mm. You know, living in this city, like, I never had, you know, really enemies or people who was after me, you know. So it's just like, I tell a lot of kids now, like, man, you don't want to play in a game where you got to always look over your back.
Right.
You know, make your money, go spend it how you want it, come home and relax. Some people, they got money, but they could go any day now because they know they doing people dirty and all types of stuff.
So, yeah, man.
Karma plays a big part, man.
It does, man. That's a part. That's a big part of being a good businessman or woman. Is your reputation is almost like a second representation. It moves in the street when you're not there. You know what I'm saying?
It'll you can either get more customers,
get less. You know what I mean? Like your reputation really does affect business deals and
plays a big part in how you start. So what we were talking about earlier, we were talking about social media, and what I was trying to explain to somebody yesterday was, if you that person who always posting all this lewd, crazy, you know, like off the wall stuff, and you never ever post anything of any substance or anything of any meaning, people just kind of lump you in that basket as like, oh, he's the crazy meme guy. You know what I mean?
Right.
Or you never post anything, but you just lurk all the time and you never really interact with people.
Right.
It's hard for you to want to come and all of a sudden want everybody to interact with you because you're starting a business. So for me, in that aspect, I joke, I play, I post crazy memes, but I also post like my life, things that are going on. Like, I'll post a picture of me in my relationship. I'll post a picture of me on date night, or I'll post a picture of me at a political function. You know, with some of my, you know, best friends are in politics.
Okay.
But, you know, I show that variety on my page where you get a mixture, where some people just one way,
right,
and then they want to come into, well, come into a social media with a whole different lane for their business, and people don't take them serious. So it's like, for me, I was able to, you know, start building my movement long before I sold my first product. I was able to, like, start hitting people and say, hey, I got something coming. Oh yeah, you know, I've been grinding, working on this. You know, people see you in the gym working out. You know, they see, like, your work ethic before that. Those things, you know, go a long way. And then that's how you transfer that energy into what it is that you're doing. But I tell people, it's not get on there and post. It's strategic.
Yeah,
it's really strategic, man. Like, it's real. Like, you got to look at the insights. You got to see what times your followers are on there. You got to see which posts got the most likes. Why did it get the most likes? And think about, you know, what you posted. Like, why did I post this, and what made everybody like this over post I thought was going to be the fire post? Because you got some posts, you'd be like, I'm keeping this one in my hip pocket, boy. And you drop that bad boy, and especially from a business perspective, you're like, ooh, when I drop this hat, oh, they're going to go crazy over this one, Joe. And it's like, nobody likes the post. And
you're
like,
that's the
you're
word.
Refreshing your phone, like,
I feel like, bro.
Like, yeah, like, did I mess up my, change my privacy settings? And you look, you got three likes. So it's one of the things where you got to definitely be strategic, but more importantly, you can't always make those posts about you and your business. Like, I tell people who are doing other businesses, post about the category. Post about, like, some things that go along with it. And that's one of the reasons why I made my brand a lifestyle brand. Because if it was only beards and you didn't have a beard, why would you follow?
Right,
like,
right.
So why would I have any women following me if all I posted about was beards?
Yeah.
So it's, you know, jokes about dating a bearded man, jokes about, you know, this and that. But it's also the unisex hats that I carry. It's also the ladies' t-shirt,
right,
beard rider. You know what I mean? So it's like those things, like, early on was just racy enough to, like, get people to follow, but then it's like sometimes you just post about lifestyle stuff, like, oh, you know, Jay-Z inks a deal with Sprint for Title, or oh, Russ just, you know, sold a Rush card to the Dot Company or whatever, Blue Dot, Red Dot, whatever they call it,
Blue Dot,
Green Dot, Yeah, Green Dot. So Green Dot, where you know, the cars they use in jail and stuff. But
yeah.
You know, so it's like those types of things open it up. But so many people are so caught up on trying to be me,
right?
And they're so focused on sales that they miss the boat. And a lot of people just like, I'm not even interested in what you're selling because you're just pushing it on me. You're slapping it in my face.
Yeah. So how did you come up with actually creating a bearded product? You know, just, you know, the natural products that you use. You talk about, you know, using shea butter and all those ingredients. How did you come up with that?
So for me, it was just basically like, I never really was even, I mean, I was like, okay, I want to put something in my beard, but I wasn't really sure what to put in. And a friend of mine had gave me some stuff at one point, and I liked it. It was okay, but it was too shiny.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, the story goes, like, I was in the airport, and when I got back, that product he gave me was pretty much melted. And wow. That happens a lot with natural products.
Right.
Uh-huh. That's the one, like, hiccup downside to this business is I don't want to change the formula because it's natural, but in the summertime, you can't leave that joint in your car.
Right.
You know what I mean? You can't. It's hard to even ship it without running the risk of, you know, melting or anything. And people are like, well, can't you do something to it? But that's the key to it. It's staying natural. It's like if you got to put something that's solidified in or to make it more loose, you changing up the natural aspect of it. But I tried something out. I liked it. I got to talking to the person who manufactured it. And I was like, look, I'm trying to go into business and do something. And they was like, okay, let's talk more. We started having a couple meetings. After a couple meetings, we looked at some numbers and we looked at some things. And I never wanted to be a person to manufacture my own product.
Okay.
So basically, I was just like, you know, let's partner. And, you know, so I'm not in the kitchen making a product. But, you know, that's one of the questions I got a lot when I started. Like, people wanted to know if I made it. You know, like, well, who makes it? You know, like, you know, how did it, like, people want to know, like, so many questions to the point where I'm like, no, that's none of your business. Right. You know what I mean? But just know that this is the product. But after a couple of weeks, I mean, those questions stop.
Yeah.
So, like, right now, people realize, like, it's no way I can go through, I could sit in the kitchen and make these products and market them and sell them and do the things that I'm doing. So, today I announced on Facebook, I just got KC Beauty Supply. So they own 6 beauty supply stores in the Baltimore area.
Congratulations.
So they got Mondawmin, East Point Mall, and then they have Liberty Road, Catonsville, Joppa Road, Towson area. And then the Columbia store is being built right now.
Okay.
So, you know, 6 stores with that type of volume.
Yeah.
You know, they placed a big order last night, and a girl was like, oh, let me give you a check before you leave. And I'm like, okay. Like,
oof. This is different. Like, right.
I'm not used to getting a check before I leave. They're like, you know, like, when you going to bring this back? And I was like, man, it's not enough money to skip town. But I was like, you know, I'll make sure I have your product for you next week. But that was big because it started with a small beauty supply store right here on Charles Street. Black owned. Shout out to Beauty Plus, my man Quentin. And that was big for me because I was also like worried about like wanting to like, oh, I want to be in Target one day. Oh, I want to be in CVS. But it's like right under my nose was a black beauty supply store here.
Right.
And I mean, they do a good volume. And a lot of people go there because of my product. And I mean, they have their own customers. A lot of people go there because they're like, this is the place in town where I can get this product. Because a lot of people don't like to order online.
Right.
So then to make this deal where I got 6 stores in the area combined with, you know, his store. And then I got a store in Forestville down in PG, black owned beauty supply store. Shout out to Glorious Beauty Supply down in PG. But all of this just helps create an environment to where people can get the product and it pushes it more.
Yeah.
Because you got people walking in and you got people still ordering with me online. Online business is flourishing. I'm still in 25 barbershops. I'm in 5 barbershops in 5 different states. I'm in, you know, Love My Lashes in Towson, a female boutique that does eyelash services.
Okay.
So, I mean, it's not just, you know, Angel Park Boutique. Like you mentioned, the first person to give me a shot.
Yeah.
Shout out Angel Park Boutique, 1707 Alisana. But it's more about doing things differently. And I came at it from a different lane where you seen me with the pop-up shop. And I'm like, you know, I want to pull up and pop up here. But then it was like people hitting me like, oh, I want you to do an event this Saturday at my church. We setting up some tables and we're going to be on the side of Hilton. No, I'm not doing that. You know what I mean? Because that wasn't what I wanted my brand.
Yeah, exactly.
There's nothing wrong with, like people setting up like little extravaganzas and stuff, because there's a lot of small businesses out here trying to move their stuff.
Yeah.
I just don't like to do that. I'm not paying $100, you know, to do your church function, and then I sell five things and I don't even make my money back.
Right, exactly.
You know, and that's not my crowd. Like, I'm more, I want the hipster, the young, you know, guy who is trying to do this. Like this weekend, I'm doing a brunch with Kitchen Cray.
Okay.
So Kitchen Cray is a very popular chef who does, you know, brunches, brunch day parties up and down the East Coast with different promoters and different places out of D.C. and New York. So it's all about the movement, man. Like, it's just about doing different stuff, bringing a different energy to this town. And the people behind me, man. Like, I definitely feel like the people behind me.
Yeah. Well, I was going to ask you about, there's a common theme in all the stuff you're saying. It's like a currency that you want to maintain. Like, you know, social currency, a reputation that creates a currency. When did you realize that you could, that you had the ability to create the currency and then expand it? Because it sounds like something that you have a grasp of for the most part. It sounds very strategic.
Yeah, so I mean, I threw parties, did a lot of events. And one thing I learned early on is, you know, it's the women. You know, I can definitely say black women are very supportive. There's an article to back that up. It was just an article saying that, like, their brand loyalty.
Yes,
and they have a guilt feeling almost that they have to support black businesses.
Yeah.
And it's, like, real. It was, like, in an article about how they will go to certain lengths to make sure that they're supporting.
And champion it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Forever.
And they will let you know quick, you know.
That's
so cool. It's, like, one of those things where you get that support, but you don't want to piss them off at the same time. So it's like, and I love that because I want that feedback. And I'm on Amazon now, but, you know, the ability to make it where I was at was strictly off the backs of black women buying their products for men. Because these women were like, okay, my man needs this for his beard.
Exactly.
And it was like, let me buy the whole kit. So they'll buy a $50 beard care kit, whereas a dude will say, let me just try one jar. And I'm like, yo, you should get the soap and the shampoo. And they'd be like, nah, I don't need to wash my face. I'm going to just put some water on it and keep throwing the butter in. And I'm like, well, it's accumulating because it's something you're putting in your hair and your skin.
Right.
Nah, I'll catch you next go around. But the women, they're like, nah, he needs everything.
Right.
You know, the brush, the comb. That's the currency. So that's the wave. It starts, you know, with, they're the ones who will support, you know, a campaign fundraiser. They're the ones who will come to an event that you're doing. So when you start to realize, like, okay, women, we do everything for women. I tell my girl all the time, I only take showers because of you being a woman.
I told her.
If I didn't, like, the days that I know I'm, like, in the house and I'm not doing it, I rarely shower. So she's just like, you're just disgusting. And I'm like, because it's like, what's the point? Like, if I don't have nothing going on, like, I don't feel the need to run a barbershop and get a shape up or nothing. But if I'm like, oh, I'm going somewhere, like, I need to clean up real quick. But we do that for women. Like, we are in a city where we focus a lot on labels and clothes and sneakers. Because when we were younger, we didn't want to get joked. You know, so it's not one to be joked. You had to be fresh. And then that's why a lot of dudes ended up hustling and getting in the stuff that they had no business into, because it was like, we was worried about if you had the Jordans or you had the Nikes or, you know, when Easter came, you wasn't fresh. So if, like, you came from, like, real bad circumstances and you ain't have your family backing you and, you know, your dad or your mom working hard to get you a certain thing you want, you're like, I got to do what I got to do to get myself all, you know, fresh.
Right.
So we do it for women, and they are our biggest supporters at the same time. So
yeah, you gotta love black women, man. And like you said, like, not only are they looking out for your business, they're looking out for the person that they care about. So they you know, supporting a whole community. Like, they giving you their money because, you know, they want to support you and what you do, but they're also looking out for their man. They say, you know, I want my man to be well taken care of, so I'm gonna get this for him, make sure he got everything he need, and he's good. Like, those type of things is what needs to be championed more and spoken about more, especially by black men, because we got to support our women as much as they support us.
Yeah, you know, yo, if you listen to this right now and you ain't done it in a while, just grab some flowers or something, man. Like, $3.99, like Trader Joe's.
Yeah.
Like, that's my sweet spot. Like, I'll go in there, get some beautiful sunflowers, and this might be like four or five, you know, flowers, but you know, for $4 or $5, you're just basically saying, baby, I appreciate you.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
You know, you're taking her out to the movies this weekend. You've been dating her for 6 years, or you're married to her. When the last time you went on a date and gave her some flowers before the date started? Like,
yeah.
Those are the little things right there that make a woman feel like you still care, and yeah. You're not just yeah. like totally, you know, just like, you know, when we going to get it in? All right, if we ain't getting it in, I'm about to go play my game.
Right, right.
You know, because that's what I do. We just put the PlayStation yeah, on. Man. Ain't no chances enough of happening. I'm going to just play my game. Yeah. So it's just about reciprocating. You see a lot of women, they go above and beyond. And then a lot of times when dudes like, she don't do the same things she used to do no more, it's because you don't do the same
exactly.
things.
Right.
Yeah.
So, you know, not to beat up on her brothers.
No, I get it. You know? I get it. I try to tell my girl as often as possible, man. Like, her birthday was really recently, and she likes Harry Potter. So I got her a Harry Potter cake, like a specially made cake with the Harry Potter glasses Word. On it. And I got, so we.
I'm sure that made her happy.
She was super happy.
That's
man.
What
it
they
was
say,
like,
you know, the thought is what counts. Yeah, like, no man, matter what it is, as long as you put your feeling behind yeah. it,
I
appreciate it.
You should always, always extend, you should always express it. As even if it seems like it's soft or mm-hmm. you, it doesn't matter. It doesn't right. matter. This is the person that you could be soft around. You could yeah. be vulnerable around.
It's an extension of your mom.
Yeah, I mean, seriously.
So like,
seriously.
If your mother ain't love you, you probably gonna have a hard time loving women.
So true, man.
But if you love your mother, like, I can still go and be around my mother and get that feeling of like, this is my mom. Yeah. So I want to be able to have that same affection and love from my woman
yeah.
versus like being in an affectionless situation when a woman has no affection or is like cold. That's a strange feeling, and you gotta get away from that.
Yeah.
So it's like you almost want to feel that same thing you felt from your mom, but not in like a weird type
yeah,
of
yeah, definitely.
Sick way. But yeah. you know, like, you know, that's, you want to have those same type of, that same vibe or feeling like, I'm gonna do whatever to make this lady happy.
Yeah. And when your mom approves of a woman that you're dating,
mm-hmm.
Jesus Christ, bro, that shit make me tear up. Think about it. Yo, I remember,
because that's what you want. You want yeah. moms yeah. like, because you be like, oh, it don't really matter what my mother think, but in the back of your mind, you like,
it matters.
Fingers crossed, like,
right, right, right.
Please don't blow this, right, like, right. baby. Don't do nothing stupid. Right. Or why the fuck did you put that on? Because right. we going to meet moms, and like, you want to make sure like it's almost like a perfect match, because you don't want to be like, okay, well, we not coming over for Thanksgiving. Well, we're going to be there for an hour.
Right.
And if wifey not happy, you know, ain't nobody going to be happy.
Right, right.
So you want to be like, yeah, we're going to be here for a while because she comfortable.
Yeah, that's the best. My gauge is when I'm out and my mom calls me. So my mom is, she works in D.C. a lot, so she's moving around in D.C.
Yeah.
She hit me on the weekend. But she asks about my girl. She never asked about any other girl I ever dated. She's like,
wow.
How she doing? I'm like, she right beside me. She good. And then I hear, and then my girl be like, tell her I say hi. I'm like, man, I'm like,
hey. I'm like,
that's dope, man.
Yeah.
That's a good feeling.
Yeah. Because, you know, when I do that, like when I bring somebody around my family, I spend a lot of time with them, because mm-hmm. you've met my family before. Like, they have,
yo, your family
particular...
is the best. His family is the best, bro.
They just have a crazy energy. They'll ask you anything under the sun. Right. Like, they don't care if it's your first time meeting you or 100th time meeting you.
Yeah.
They say anything. So
first to ask you if you're sleeping with somebody.
Yeah, right.
I got a girl for you. You messing with somebody yep. right now? Like, she's like, I got somebody for you.
So
you,
right. So you just got to have a certain way about you. I got to make sure you can handle that energy. So That's important. You know, family is definitely something that's what we have to focus on and keep supporting.
And I think there's a it's all related, right? Mm-hmm. So the love you have for people and the people around you and people that you meet kind of translates to how your business flourishes mm-hmm. and
yeah.
how people respond to you and stuff like that. And that, it seems like, you know, from these interactions that I've been having with you in the last couple of minutes, that you have some comfort in the love that you have for your people around you and black
oh, yeah.
women and,
I mean,
and the community and stuff like that.
Like, my team is strong, man. Like,
right, right.
You know, so, you know, my best friend is Nick Mosby. He ran for mayor.
Oh, word.
Oh, wow.
His wife, Marilyn Mosby. Yeah.
Bro.
So.
I mentioned to him that I wanted to interview. Anyway, that's so crazy you say that.
Right,
yeah, I'm connected with the right people. And I mean, not because of their titles, but we was there long time ago before that. So that's, it was like, man. You know, I remember when he first told me about her when he was at Tuskegee. You know what I mean? So it was long before any of them had a title. It was just true, genuine friendship where we was, you know, talking about, you know, like, how was your grades? Right. Like, and I tell people positive peer pressure is the best thing you can have when exactly. your friends are like, yo, you know, we down here, yeah, we drinking, we doing this, we doing that, but how was your grades? Right. Like, did you do your work? Oh, okay. Now finish telling me about that party you was at till 5 a.m.
Yeah.
Like, that's the type of energy you're supposed to have where everybody's like, let's get what we gotta get done, but still we gonna get it on both sides. Word. So, you know, my other homeboy, my best friend up in Brooklyn, he you know, works on Wall Street, he's a lawyer, and you know, just to be able to bounce things off of those guys. And right. one of my other good friends, Carlton, he just won Black Engineer of the Year. And,
wow.
You know, and then my buddy Steve, he runs a catering company. So it's just people around me who are so focused. And it's not like anything where I've, like, made these friendships because mm-hmm. of who people were. Mm-hmm. These are people who I just went to school with. Mm-hmm. People who I just, you know, in my fraternity, people who were on my line, people I pledged mm-hmm. with. Like, we blood, sweat, and tears. So,
word.
You know, we've been through it in the trenches together. Yeah. So it's not like nobody's leaning on the other person. It's truly, you know, no one will fall because everyone will be each other's crutches.
Right.
Because we all, like, bring something to the table, but we all hold each other accountable. Like, there's no punches being held. Yeah. If I say, tomorrow I want to go start this, you know, gym in South Baltimore, and they be like, man, shut your fat ass up. Yeah. Like, you ain't starting no gym. Like, right, who you right. gonna put on the picture? Not your fat ass. You know what yeah. I mean? But it's, like, real, because it's, like, you gonna get that raw feedback. Nobody yeah, ain't yeah. trying to, like, hang on. So it's, like, when people trying to hang on, they'll tell you what you want to hear. Like,
yeah.
oh, yeah, I love this beer butter. Because I'm, like, yo, fellas, this is what I'm trying to do. And they was right. all, like, yeah, that's dope. And I'm like, okay, cool.
Right.
You know, really, you think it's, like, yeah, man, we'll tell you, like.
Right, right.
But, it was you know, is a lot of people who was like, beer butter, what's that? Man. Like, I'm about to create a category.
Word.
You know what I mean? Like, I'm gonna make this happen to where people gonna feel the need to put something in. But it's all about your team, man. Like, you got the right people around you. You can do anything. It's resources, it's networking, you know, because those same people would take my post and share it to their network. You know,
yeah.
Nick got 8,000 followers, you know Jesus. What I mean? It's just like who he is, you know. And the same thing I was doing for him, like when I was talking about people coming to campaign fundraisers,
yeah.
I was on social media every day, like, vote for my man for mayor, vote for my man for city council. Yeah. I was out there, you know, when it was cold, knocking on doors, when it was hot, knocking on doors, you know, making phone calls for his campaign, his wife's campaign, because that's what friends do.
Exactly.
So it's like when the time come around, you don't even have to say, hey, yo, can you share this post? It's already like, yo, I shared it and three people, you know, in Jersey asking me how can they get it.
Right,
I sent them to your website. Did you get those Jersey sales? Yeah, I got them. All right, cool. I already shipped it. Mm-hmm. That's just how it goes. Like, right. when you're in a genuine friendship, nobody has to ask anybody to do anything for you. Right. You don't have to ask your friends to support your business. My friends don't even ask for a discount code. I got a discount code just for my friends. They never use it. You know, they'll be like, hey, man, I put this order in. Like, I'm like, yeah, I seen it come through. Like, dumbass, why you ain't use the zip? I don't need no discount, man. I just want to support you. And I'm like, yeah, but it's cool because, you know, like, I'm going to give it to you. Nah, man, just pay the whole price. And I respect that.
Word.
Because it's just, like, real friendship.
Exactly.
Know?
And that's how you can tell somebody really wants to support you and really wants to see you do well. Like, when you can offer something to them and they turn it down or they don't even come to you to ask for a discount or, you know, something like that. They'll say, how much is it? All right, cool. I got you. Or they're yeah. like, I
a lot of people I gave free stuff to. There's a lot of people I gave free product to, and they never ordered
yeah.
ever. You know, never spent a dollar.
Or they'll be but like, man, if you give me this free product, I'll make sure I put everybody on. I'm like,
but
well,
that's
what
they
do.
So people say, give me some free product.
Right.
I'm going to post it to my social media.
Yeah.
And you got to DM them 5 times. Like, yo, when you going to make that post?
right.
And then they make the post at like 10:30 at night. Like, ain't nobody on. Like, yeah. yo.
Right.
And then they'll post 3 things after it. So it gets swallowed up. And you're just like.
Just inconsiderate.
Like, you just be like, that's some bullshit. But I mean, you live and you learn. And I mean, I've done some crazy things where I just sent people free product. Like, I might see somebody on Instagram, they doing a whole bunch of beer stuff. I'm like, I need your information so I can just mail you a package. Yeah. But those are the type of things you got to do to be able to make it.
I was going to say, that's business.
Yeah, that's business. And I'll take that risk 1,000 times and get nothing in return. You know, I done wrote the Steve Harvey show. I done wrote, you know, went to try to get on certain TV shows, and that's how I ended up on Fox 45. When I say AKA Mr. Fox 45, Mr. Fox 43, because
yeah.
I was on Fox 45 twice. I was on Fox 43, and it's just a matter of, you know, keep pushing that button. Like, yo, how can I get on TV?
Right.
All right, cool. You know somebody that worked there. All right, cool. I'm gonna email them. I'm gonna call them. I'm gonna be in the inbox. I'm gonna DM them.
Right.
And then everything go well. And they're like, oh, we want to have you back. You know.
That's
so
dope.
Like in York, PA. You know, it was like, we want to have you back for Father's Day. So I'm looking forward to that. I always get a nice bounce when I come off this too.
Right.
You're getting people who never even think that they would know you as a customer.
Right. Exactly.
And that's the whole reason why I'm on Amazon. Because there's people, a million people who shop every day on the world's largest internet retailer.
Right.
And they just typing in stuff in the search engine. Whatever, and one day they're going to hit beer butter. Just like today, I got two orders from there. And it's just people who just searching. You don't know who they are. But you might hit that right person who might work for Steve Harvey and right? be like, yo, I'm using this new stuff. Like, we got to get this dude on. Like, you know, I'm going to find out who he is. Young black entrepreneur out of Baltimore. Cool. He got a great story.
Right.
And the next thing you know, like, that's how you make it.
Yeah.
That's incredible, man. That's getting some momentum in that way is a really good idea. And congratulations for the TV appearances, man.
TV appearances, Amazon.
Yeah, Amazon is.
KC Beauty, like, you know, Beauty Plus. It's just small wins, one after another.
Exactly.
Right.
It's like one of those things where I always say, like, just expect it. Just expect it. Like, if you expect it, you're not, like, truly, like, emotional every time it happens. I do get sometimes, like, I'm riding in the car and, you know, last night took an L, but tonight I bounced back. And I'm like, boy, my allergies are starting to kill me because it's like been so much stuff that's been going on. And a year ago, I didn't think I would be here, but you know, that type of thing. But truly, like, I really calculate like a lot of moves. So it's good when they finally come to fruition, because it's like the Amazon thing was like a long time running. It was like taking me like 3 weeks to a month to get on there.
Yeah.
I'm like, damn. But it wasn't so much making money on Amazon, because it was like I make good money on my website. Like, it grows every month. Like, I'm on this type of, you know, thing where it's just going up every month. Like, it's just a blessing. But the one thing about Amazon is it's like walking in a room and having that, like, security badge that only you can get in certain places.
Yeah.
Right. So what Amazon does, if we sitting here and you a major retailer, or we sitting at Wit and Wisdom at a bar and you somebody and I say, oh, I got these products.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. You're just somebody who started a business. Yeah, I'm on Amazon too. Amazon carry that weight.
Yeah.
Right. So it's like dropping some initials, like, oh yeah, you know, I'm a CIA, BSS, you know, Masters in Science, PhD,
right,
you know, oncology, whatever.
Right.
That's what it is. So I tell people all the time, like, man, like, you can have your own online business. You can have certain things. But until you get into certain stores and certain retail outlets and be able to offer that to other people, you got to walk in with a resume.
Yeah.
You know, it's the same thing. Like, you build your work resume, you're building your business resume.
Yep.
Right.
And you got to know your market, man. If you think your products are going to do well on Amazon, figure out any way possible to get on Amazon. Or if you feel like,
even if they not,
yeah,
just be on there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Don't nobody know your sales? I mean, at the end of the day, like, who knows your sales? Like, you could just be like, yo, I'm on Amazon.
Yeah.
And you're just paying the fee, the individual seller account fee, which is like,
$35 or something. It's something small.
It's something small, but it's also an individual seller's account where it's like 99 cents for everything you sell.
Mm.
In a percentage of what you sell. So
okay. You
could do that one where it's like you really ain't being charged nothing. So if you ain't selling nothing, you could just be on that one joint where it's just like you got the logo under you. You know what I mean? I say at the end of the day, everybody want to be under the umbrella, because, you know, you want to be under the umbrella. Like, so it's people who want to be attached to me, want to be attached to the brand. That's cool. You want to be under the umbrella because we're going to make it rain.
Right,
and when it start raining, like, you're going to be underneath. You're going to be safe. You're going to be good. And you're going to get access to my network and my market. Like, man, I got some major things, like, people around me that's doing some big stuff. Like, we got Rams and Parrots coming. It's a bourbon company, black owned, three kids from West Baltimore, and they just started their own bourbon company. They're in three different cities, but they're all from Baltimore. And I mean, it's like 140 proof, tastes good, like, you know, everything, the vanilla notes and the honey. But, you know, we cigar smokers by trade, all of us smoke.
Okay.
So, you know, it pairs well with the cigars. But, I mean, it's just so many different things we're doing. I got my man coming out with Gain Sportswear. He's creating some products to help you out in the gym as far as, like, with your lifting and your pull-ups. You know, just something to, like, work under your hands. They're not gloves, but they kind of, like, almost like a, help you grip.
Okay.
Right, but right, without, right. like, you know, the weight falling or, like, your hand sliding off the bar right. when you're trying to get a pull-up. Or you wrap it around, and it keeps you from letting go
right.
doing certain okay. exercises. So, man, we got a lot of different things just in the works. Like, my closest friends. Like, my buddy Chico with the Gang Sportswear.
Mm.
You know what I mean? That's my beard model that everybody always see. Young Billy D. You know, he got the, like, Cambodian, Dominican look with the wavy hair.
Well, okay.
And then, you know, he got the big beard. So, it's like, I bounce off of him. You know, I know he knows as soon as he start his thing, I'm right there with him. You know, it's just, that's the wave, man. We starting our own businesses. We add incremental income. You know, we're creating passive income. We're doing a lot of different things whereas, you know, we just creating something new and fresh and the energy is vibrant.
Mm.
You know, nothing against, like, the multi-level marketing. A lot of people have done MLMs where, you know, they're just getting people because people want to be making, you know, money. But what we're doing right. is we finding niches. We're finding
right.
a niche in a marketplace yeah. where there's an opportunity and a way for us to create a lane. And what I'm doing is I'm not scared to say that I'm a black-owned business and I sell products for black men.
Mm.
Those same products work well for white men. So if you have a beard and you're white, don't be offended because, right, you know, right, that's what yeah. our marketing targets. But if the next time you're walking in down the street, count the number of black men in Baltimore City or in this world that has a beard when you look on TV
yeah.
versus the number of white men that shave their face every day.
Right, right.
If I was selling razors, it would be open to everybody. But yeah. my beard products, I could sell my beard products to only black men and be a trillionaire.
Good.
You know, like I would Literally. Never,
you definitely could.
I would never feel bad like, oh, I haven't had right. one white sale. Like, yeah. what's going on? I had a white guy buy my beard butter on Amazon last week because he only wanted to use it for his mustache.
Mm, okay.
For his mustache.
Yeah.
But he's like, I love the way this stuff smells.
Yeah.
And, you know, he got introduced to it from a friend who worked at Trader Joe's with him. So
oh, okay.
it's just little things like that. But it's not because he looked at the packaging and was like, this looks like a black man.
Yeah.
But a lot of times when we go to use products and it's waxy and it's oily,
yeah.
it
yeah.
doesn't fit us.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I think my products are versatile to fit both, but you know, my marketing and my target market is the African-American male. Yeah.
And I think what it is we're afraid to say that. A lot of us are afraid to say that, but we shouldn't be. Because when we go to Target or mm-hmm. Safeway or whatever, when you go in there and see those products, it's white people on the products. It's,
exactly.
it's catered to white people. When you see the commercials for it, it's white people.
Yeah.
And those products, like you've been saying, those products aren't tailored towards us, so they don't particularly work for right. our style of hair or our body type or whatever it is. So it's okay to say this is for this particular person. Like if it's for black people, it's
even being in
the wake for us.
Even being in pharmaceutical sales, a lot of the drug studies always excluded black people.
Mm.
So they'd be like, oh, this trial was done randomized double blind placebo. You know, we took this group over here, we gave them this blood pressure medicine, we gave this people placebo.
Mm-hmm.
This group did really well. And then when you get down into the study characteristics, it'd be like 20,000 people in Scandinavia. But like right. okay, like there's no black people there.
Right.
So then it's like we're trying to sell this product in East Baltimore to clinics where people have severe hypertension.
Right.
So it's like, you know, it wasn't so many trials that used the drugs that you're selling. Like you're using, you know, these small populations in white places and yeah. now you're trying to tell us that this is gonna help us with heart attacks and strokes and we're the leading cause of cardiovascular disease deaths.
Mm-hmm.
But you're not trying any products on us,
right? Yeah.
But you know, if it's a test where you're giving us syphilis and stuff like that, we know we've been used for those.
Yeah.
You know, Hopkins. I mean, come on, Hopkins over the city like a blank check for black people because they was doing all types of stuff back in the day where they were just using black people. I know Oprah is doing a movie where about a black woman who she had this special cells and basically Hopkins, you know, did some stuff and they found this particular like almost like a cure for something.
Wow.
And I've heard about it from some people in the medical field, but yeah, Hopkins, man, they was running all types of guinea pig tests on us.
Yeah.
And people, we'll give you $500, you show up, let us shoot this heroin in you and see what happens.
Mm,
and
yeah.
see how you respond to this one, you know. And then we give you $500 if you want to stop smoking weed, come down.
Yeah.
We're gonna try this drug on you. And you know, people be like desperate. So right, it's like, yeah. you know,
and not to even to mention the housing
right now.
Oh, come on, man. The lead paint.
Yeah.
Come on, right. man.
They come to you 1 month. They're like, hey, we'll offer you this amount of money. You say no. They come back like, we please. And then you say no, and then they bully you and give you nothing.
Right. Mm-hmm.
It's crazy, man. It's you know, it is what it is.
We could touch on a lot. Yeah, man. But that's one thing I love about being around good energy and good dudes, because it's like, we could do this all day. Like, we could we could talk about so many issues in the city, like we talked about earlier.
Yeah.
The culture, the food, the exposure. It's two different Baltimores.
Definitely. It is. And the problem is, especially when it comes to the arts, the narrative about what Baltimore art is starting to become a little more white. You know what I'm saying? Like, when I do stand up and I travel around a lot of the spots in some of the artsier areas. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like North Avenue, where North Avenue wasn't.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? Like, going to North Avenue now is weird.
When Joe Square moved up the street, I was like, damn, they moving up the street.
Right.
And then I went there to go get my favorite wings, and I'm like, let me get my honey srirachas. Like, this is North Avenue. Yeah, right. Like, I came out to my car and I look across the wind up spaces, like people with like the big earrings, like with their earlobe stretched out.
It's crazy when you go to certain parts of Baltimore where you couldn't normally walk around and you see white people at night walking around with their dogs.
Yo.
Yeah.
I remember the first time I saw.
That's when you know it's safe.
Yeah.
First time like I ever saw a white person walk down Greenmount.
Mm-hmm.
I said, what? Because, you know,
that's about to change. Like, Greenmount is already under construction.
Yeah.
And people don't even realize, like, they about to just, you know, these main streets, the goal is to make all these main streets, Greenmount, Charles Street, you know, change it. Like, when Choices basically shut down and all them little restaurants popped up around Choices and the little theater, the Charles Theater and all that stuff started to change. And then on the Senator, it's Center Bistro.
Yeah.
It's like so much stuff going on in the city, and people will be missing the boat because they so trapped into like their way of thinking that they never allow themselves to get out of that mindset.
Right. Yeah.
But it's like also they haven't never been exposed to.
Yep.
So, you know, that's why I say, man, it's two Baltimores. And I'm happy that I've been exposed to all of it.
Yeah.
You know, but.
And they give it another name too. I don't know what they're going to call that area. That's Greenmount. Crazy. They're going to be like. Like.
The Mount.
Charles North proper or something like that. Right. It's like they're going to extend North Charles Village.
Right.
Yeah. Like they always come up with something.
Like when people say New Waverly. Like
when
we were talking and you said Waverly. Yeah, that's Waverly. A term that a lot of white people would describe the district.
Right.
Oh, yeah, Mary Pat Clark is the city council rep for Waverly.
Yeah.
You mean Greenmount and 33rd?
Right, right.
Like, you mean where the boulevard used to be, where, like, people used to get shot in the movies?
That movie, I went to go see Dick Tracy there.
I seen the wrestling movie.
The one with Hulk Hogan?
The one with Hulk Hogan.
And
Zeus.
Zeus, yeah.
Yeah, I seen
No that. Holds Barred.
No Holds Barred.
That you saw like, No Holds
Barred? That was like the last movie ever there.
Yo.
My buddy, he lived down Barkley and 21st. Okay. And, you know, that's my man. He got shot. He's been shot 13 times.
Wow.
And he's still alive to this day. But by the time we was 13, 14, he was selling guns. He got shot up at the dice game. It was a big dice game. Like 8 people got shot. It was putting people on stretchers. And I was 14 and my mom was like, that's your best friend. And I'm like, Ma, you blame everybody for everything. Like everybody's selling drugs. Everybody's getting high. And she like, no, that's him. And I'm like, yeah, okay. He come home from the hospital like 5 days later and he got like 5 bullet wounds. And I'm like, damn. But that was pushing him down that path because down that way, he just did what he want. Like when he wasn't with his dad around my way, it was like taking advantage of the single mom. You know, I'm going to do what I want. I'm going to be outside.
Yeah.
And we was in No Holds Bars, and I remember him just taking pennies, like, just throwing them. I'm like, dude, you get us killed. And he just, like, the whole movie doing it, and, like, people like, who the fuck was throwing those pennies? And we just walk right out, and I'm just like, man, like, this dude, wow.
Jesus, man.
Yeah, that's my fondest memory at the Boulevard.
For real?
Yeah, I went to the movie by myself to see No Holds Bars. And I went to Nifty Cleaners for 20 years.
Right
across the street.
Word.
Seen it change ownership like 20 times, you know. Yeah.
I remember when there was a Woolworth down the street.
Mm-hmm.
God damn. Yeah. It's like, it's weird to think just how different it was.
Yeah.
I love that neighborhood, man. I used to go to the Lake Trout, get gizzards.
Mm-hmm.
and a chicken box.
Yeah, I grew up in Northeast Baltimore, so yeah, I remember a lot of that. I remember my a lot of my fondest memories too was the Orioles. I played baseball at Northwood, and what we used to do was the Ripken baseball. The Ripken family would do a, like a baseball clinic for us, and they would like the father, Ripken Senior, and you know Cal and Billy, and they would do like hitting clinics, and we learned how to hit and throw, you know, field balls, and they bring like us down, show us the dugouts and all of that.
Wow, at Memorial Stadium.
Yeah, we get to go to the games.
Wow.
And then what my dad would do, I was one of the only people in my neighborhood with a father who lived in the house.
Mm-hmm.
So we were kind of like looked at as the Huxtables because my dad like had a good job, my mom stayed at home. You know, but it was four of us. She couldn't really work. Understanding now that what she would have made in a wage probably wouldn't have been able to help because we would have been going to daycare or something like that. Right. So it made more sense for her to stay home. And, you know, she was the Kool-Aid mom. You came over, she was going to whip up some, you know, pink lemonade or whatever package she had in there, pour a lot of sugar in it. Everybody out on the porch after playing football going to get some lemonade. But my dad, what he would do was take us all to three-buck night. So, you know, looking back on it, like $3 to get into the game, six kids, $18, him.
Not bad.
That's nothing.
That's
you know?
Not bad.
And we would just leave off my block and literally, like, race to get to the stadium.
Yeah.
And, I mean, I look at that type of stuff, and that's where I get it from. Like, I do a lot of giving back. So I got a nonprofit that I'm rolling out next month at Carver High School.
Wow.
Where it's called H.U.S.T.L.E.R. Academy. Mm. And it stands for Helping Uplift Students the Legal Entrepreneur Route. And that's based off of what I've been doing with my business. So it's great that I'm doing great with my business, but how can I reach back and empower some of these kids to start their own business? One of the best things to do was to start it at a school where some of these kids are not thinking about college because they have technical trade skills, something I never had.
Mm-hmm.
But they might can build something or use their hands to make something or, you know, they can bake something, whatever.
Right.
But I want to channel that energy where it's like, don't just go take this skill and work for this dude for 30 years. And then you look up and you don't have nothing.
Yeah.
Go work for him.
Yeah.
But also on the weekend, make that Harry Potter cake if you can do it.
Right,
you know what
right.
I mean? If you can change oil, do it at Jiffy Lube.
Yeah.
But buy you a garage in the hood off the neighborhood corner and start doing oil changes.
Because the thing is, working for those people, they can get rid of you at any time. Like, there's no security. Like, you can lose whatever you had saved up, whatever pension they give you, all that can just be gone overnight. So just have something on the burner to keep yourself safe and secure. Yeah.
And they'll steal your blueprint.
Yeah.
They'll steal you how you work. They'll watch you.
Yeah, intellectual property. They tell you when you sign that job. And I mean, we've all worked for major corporations. We're talking about some big ones here.
Yeah, right.
And you know when you sign that paper,
oh,
if you don't sign, first of all, you're not going to start.
Yeah,
you're in the HR process. You done already accepted that nice, cushy little job offer, and they tell you sign 50 pages, and you don't even pay attention to the fact that, one, you're an at-will employee. Mm-hmm. We can let you go whenever.
Yep.
Right.
And then the second thing is, we own your intellectual property while you work here. Right. So anything you come up with on our computer, our time, we own
ours.
It.
Right.
So you can come up with the greatest idea that this company going to make $1 billion off of. Right. You don't get a pat on your ass.
Yeah.
You know, good job. And don't threaten your
$500 bonus, but they're making billions off what you just
and don't
did.
Threaten the fact that your manager might feel a little nervous by the fact that you know, grinding and you came up with this great new idea.
Right.
You know, they'll start pushing you out because they feel like, oh, this motherfucker gonna take my job.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Right. Yeah, right.
And, you know, for me, I was always like, I'm usually one of the only black people at work.
Exactly.
You know, the last couple companies I work for, this one is a little different. You know, I work with a lot of black people, you know, fortunately. But it doesn't matter to me because I learned to swim wherever I'm at.
Exactly.
But, you know, the difficult thing is I found was as an African-American male, when I had arguments or confrontation with my white counterparts, I was like too confrontational or I was too aggressive.
Right.
And it would be like, no, motherfucker, like you wait till I had my review to bring up some bullshit from February and it's fucking July.
Yeah,
like, motherfucker, you not about to ding me and not give me another $1,000 because you pussy and you scared. It ain't nothing to do with, you know, whatever. I'm just checking you on your shit.
Yeah.
But that's the thing. People don't want
because
me
of who you
on
are. They're intimidated already.
Yeah. And then it's like, you know, as a man, you know, you 40, 44, 46 suit, you know, broad shoulders, and then you got, you know, this little small guy. And then the thing everybody always asks you, like, who'd you play football for? I didn't fucking play football. I'm not that athletic. Right. Like, I'm like, I could probably play at the company picnic and be better than y'all. Yeah, right. But I'm not an athlete just because I'm a certain size. Like, yeah. I wasn't the size all my damn life. Like, I'm slow. Like, I played baseball because I was slow. I could hit it far and get to first base. Yeah. Like, it's crazy, man.
It is crazy. Stereotypes.
Back to, you know, the business before, you talked about it, you know, having shortcomings and things like that. Like, from the inauguration of your business up to now, like, what things have you gone through, and like, how have you overcome those things to keep yourself pushing?
So when I came out, I was talking about how I couldn't really ship, and I was like really worried about the shipping aspect, and it was a new business, so I couldn't take the risk of like not being able to ship my product with mm-hmm. it melting and everybody getting it and it's melted.
Right.
So I just hustled out the trunk. I mean, I was just like, put everything in my car, run the air conditioner. Like, if I had to, I had to run, like, get a cooler and just keep it in my car and just do whatever. But I had to do a lot of pop-up shops. I had to do a lot of deliveries hand-to-hand. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, it made me touch people more, because my goal coming out was I wanted to be national.
Right.
But the one thing I had to do was build home first.
Exactly.
Right. So it was like, I wanted to build home, but I also wanted to be national so bad that I didn't care if nobody supported me here. It was just like, I want everybody to be like, I want to be shipping everywhere. I want to be doing this. I want to be doing that. But it built this mantra where it was just like made in Baltimore.
Mm.
And I seen it based off some products. And it's a new campaign going on where you'll be able to put that on products. Mm. Like a sticker saying made in Baltimore. If it's made right here with raw materials and everything.
Wow.
From Baltimore. And so my thing was like, all my stuff was made in Baltimore. Like my toiletry bags that I have now is made in Baltimore. I got a manufacturing plant that makes my toiletries. I got a guy who makes my soap and my shampoo. Mm. So everything's made in Baltimore. And that started to make me feel like really good about it. Mm-hmm. So I created a patch that says made in Baltimore. And it's coming out on a hat in like a month or so. And
I will be purchasing
that. So it's like,
that's dope.
And what it really came back to was me
mm-hmm.
made in Baltimore.
Right, right.
Built tough. Right. Like, and I mean, this city ain't for the faint of heart. Like, you know, I tell anybody who can make it here, you're going to be sharp because you've been in some situations here. And, you know, it's diverse, but it's rough. And you learn a lot about who you are just trying to make it in the city. So make it in the city and then making it in business. Woo. You know, that's two things. Yeah, so
right.
And everybody always talking about so many crabs in the barrel and this and that. Yeah, I seen some hate. I didn't have my share of hate, but what I do is I focus on the positive.
Exactly.
Like, I could tell you some stories about dudes just straight up hating, walking a barbershop, and they like, man, I should have thought of that shit right in your face.
Yeah.
And then they like, no, we don't need nothing. We good. You know what I mean? And then you get in the parking lot, some dude like, hey, yo, let me get one of them. You know what I mean? Like, just try carrying me. But, right. You know, it's like, you focus on the positive. If you follow me on social media, I always put out the positive. Like, I feel myself, if I'm about to click something to sound negative, I delete it because I don't want that wave. I don't want that energy because there's a lot of people who post that, you know, like, if you don't fuck with me, fuck you. You say you're going to buy my stuff, support me. I don't put that out there.
Right,
there's
right,
plenty
right.
of people I could go at like that.
Yeah.
I mean, it's people who I grew up with, and it's like, dog, like, you know, remember I supported you on your little, you know, bubblegum machines you were selling. I bought one for my kid and it didn't even work after 3 weeks.
Right, right.
But that's the type of stuff where nobody wants to hear that. People want to be associated with a winner. So I could talk about a bunch of hiccups and things that happen. I just learn from them. But what I do is I also pass it to you.
Right.
Like, you say you got some merch coming. When we get out this joint, I already got like some people who can do some amazing things for you, whether it's patches, whether it's hats, you know, whether it's embroidery, whatever it is that you want to do. I did it already. And I tell my friends that's doing the same stuff, if you see me making a hat, approach me about making a hat. I didn't learn who these vendors was because I, you know, stumbled upon them.
Right, right.
I fell on my face a little bit, but I also was able to pick up the phone and say, hey, yo, I remember you were selling them hats. Well, I see your page up right now. I'm not trying to compete with you. And they're like, nah, brother, like, you good.
Yeah.
Call this guy. Yeah. You know, go on this site and order your hats.
Exactly.
And then get it done here. And that's the same thing. I had a guy call me 2 days ago, and he like, yo, who made your patches? This is one of my hats right now with the leather patch on, sewn on. Okay. And he like, who doing your cut and sew? And I'm like, this the people that's doing it.
Yeah.
But I also got another guy in New York right now who can help you out right away. He'll get it to you faster.
Yeah.
He called me last night like, yo, it was an amazing call. We about to do this. We doing this, wow. this, and this. He got the plug in China. He doing this.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I passed them to you because I know he can help you.
Right,
you know,
right,
if we, if I win, we all win.
Yeah, and that's what's missing. Like, we have to support each other, not, you know, just buying each other products, but if we're trying to start businesses and, you know, you 5 years in the game or however long you're doing it, and I'm coming in, this is my first year, I'm coming to you for advice, just help me out.
You
don't got to give me your whole blueprint of what you did, but, you know, just give me some advice, let me know what I can't do.
9 times out of 10, we not even competing.
Yeah, you know? Exactly.
Like my man selling sweatshirts and t-shirts and hats and stuff like that, his lane is completely different from mine.
Yeah, you got a different audience. You like, cater to different people.
I'm going to still try to mix my crowd with yours and stuff like that, but that's not going to make them buy it. But, you know, I'm going to introduce you to some different people. But, like, yo, we not in competition. Half of the time, we not even in the same lane with people, but we get intimidated or people don't want to see other people blow up.
Yeah.
Like, they feel
they don't want to see somebody do better than what they doing. Right. They feel people, that should be somewhere else.
That's a saying that, like, it's a meme that I love. People love to see you good, doing good, but never better than them.
Exactly.
So,
yes.
It's like, people will be like, yo, you doing good. But then when you get to a certain point, people are like, oh, this motherfucker doing too good.
Right.
Like, was that you on that boat on vacation?
Yeah,
and
right.
How did you get on that? And I'm like, oh, I'm doing great. And it's like,
we oh, from yeah, the same city. How you out here on boats and stuff like that?
Exactly.
And I can't do that.
They love the come up story, man. They hate once you get to a point where you beside KD. How you get beside KD? Yeah,
exactly.
I hate you.
Right.
So that's good. Then it becomes the stories about how you don't support nobody. And
you don't come back home.
Yeah, all that type of stuff. You don't come out no more. It's crazy, but man, I'm feeling great right now. The energy is great.
That's good to hear.
That's good, man.
I wake up some. I swear to God, my phone could go off like in the middle of the night, and there'd be an order.
Mm-hmm.
I will get up like 3 a.m. and pack that order up. People will tell you I ship faster than anybody.
Wow.
Because that's my thing. Like, my thing is customer service.
Yeah.
And I always think of me. So when people don't order online from me and it take them 4 months to do it, I think that's me.
Yeah.
Like, I want to support you, dude, but I keep forgetting to go online.
Yeah.
Like, if you don't literally text it to me right then and there and get the link in my hand while I'm sitting there watching TV or something, I'm just not doing it.
Yeah.
So I don't get mad when the homeboy like, yo, I want that hat. And I'm like, order it right now. And they don't do it because I know it was a time in my life where sometimes I was paycheck to paycheck and I just ain't had the $20 just to do it. So
right,
I was making
right.
a decision like, am I going to go get drunk this weekend or I'm going to support my man on this $20 hat that I really want, and then it'd be like, I get that shit when I get my taxes back.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like,
it's all good. And that's the other thing, the follow-up is so key to business. A lot of people don't understand a lot of stuff gets done just following up. Because like you said, you might forget to, you know what I mean, order something, or somebody might forget to, you know, get you back on a business note or get you in with a connection. If you just follow up with somebody, it'll get you a lot of places that you didn't think you couldn't get.
That's social media. Social media is a reminder. People tell me all the time that, oh, I was going to order your product last month. I started a cart. I didn't finish it, but I seen you post something today and it reminded me.
Yeah.
I told my husband or I told my boyfriend I was going to pick them up. Sometimes they're picking up for both.
Yeah.
I get women who are buying for their boyfriend and their husband. So it's like it's like a double dip.
Hey, you know,
right.
Hey, Valentine's Day just passed.
Right.
Shout out to the ladies with 2-3 Valentine's.
Hey, right.
Dude, y'all was killing it. I mean, it was just like,
damn.
You don't have to put that in the same box. I'm like, do you, baby?
Right. No judgment over there.
Yeah.
Valentine's Day and Christmas. If they could just run them holidays I'd be a millionaire. Women go all out, boy. Like, Valentine's Day, they was like, you know, it was like the day before, and I sold out of everything I had. Like, I didn't have nothing.
Jeez.
Like, I ain't have a shampoo, I ain't have a soap, I ain't have a butter.
Yeah.
And I was like, I don't have nothing. It was like, just give me something. And I'm like, I could put together like a comb and like a toothbrush, and you could just call it like a man's care. All right, I'm on my way. I'm like in my closet looking for an old toothbrush. Or something. But it was crazy because I fucked up this order. Like, I really fucked up.
Really?
Like, it was like crazy.
Mm-hmm.
So the chick ordered like February 7th.
Mm.
And I was like, all orders have been processed. Everybody, thank you for your Valentine's Day stuff. You know, like, if you need something, please feel free to reach out to me, but it won't ship by now to get to you.
Right.
So that's like the day before, and I'm like relaxing, got my feet kicked back. I'm like, man, I was doing like, I did like a couple racks.
Yeah,
and a couple gigs. Wow. Like, I'm like, got my feet up. Like, yeah. I'm like about to sip on a brew or something, like chill with my lady, not being bothered. And I get this email like, hey, do you know when my stuff is going to arrive? I ordered on the 7th. I'm like, everything on the, ordered on the 7th went out on the 8th.
Yeah.
And I realized that that day, I don't do pickups. Mm-hmm. But it was because it was Valentine's Day and the chick like, oh, my boyfriend, he got the car and I'm close to you. Can I just come pick it up? And I don't want to ship it. And I don't want him to get it at the house. You know, so I did that. But when I did that, I got her name confused with the next person. And I clicked that it shipped out. And man, I ain't had nothing left. So I was just sitting there like, yo, I don't have shit. How I'm going to get this girl her gift? Because I had to get her her gift.
Yeah.
And I was like, I apologize. I'm refunding you all of your money right now. Like, I refunded the whole $60.
Yeah.
And she was like, you don't have to do that. And I'm like, nah, you're going to be a customer for life because I'm going to make sure you're good.
Yeah.
So I refunded everything. And the next morning, I got up and I called like 5 barbershops. And I was like, yo, what y'all got in there? And he was like, oh, we got this, we got that. And I'm like, I'm coming to get it.
Oh,
and they're
wow.
like, make sure you bring my product away. I'm like, man, shut up. You ain't even selling. You've been sitting on this for 2 weeks.
Yeah, word.
So I went and put the whole kit together, like off of, you know, people that I had stuff in their stores. And I was able to get it to her. And I just was like, damn. But mistakes happen.
Yeah.
And the thing is what you do. It's what you do when a mistake happens that makes you a business owner rather than, you know, always trying to hold on to every penny and dollar. Like,
yeah.
I got that money right back because the next day I probably did 10 times the amount I gave back.
Wow.
Because there was a lot of people who didn't have gifts and they had to, you know, to do the little side thing for Saturday.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Valentine's Day was like Tuesday and then they had to do like the side piece or
right.
they didn't know the boyfriend was going to get them something because they was beefing. Yeah. And they like, now I got to hurry up and get something.
Right,
one
right,
of the beer
right.
kits. And then I got it all back and it all comes back.
That's dope, man. That's really dope.
So I have this thing that I've been thinking about as I get older. Just the idea that, like, what separates a good person from a shitty person is how you react to inconvenience.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Like, and once you get inconvenienced, how are you gonna? How I pay attention to that? If you got a person and they get inconvenienced, like, fuck you, fuck
yeah, yeah. fuck it's this like, man. Shit. I ain't never coming back in this
right,
bitch.
Right, right. But if you can make it right. That's dope, man.
Yeah, so, I mean, that's the thing, man. It's like, how are we going to keep this same level of enthusiasm and push and customer service?
Right.
And my biggest fear is trusting someone.
Right.
So it's like, I got to trust somebody eventually to work with me. And it's like, I almost rather groom somebody
mm-hmm.
than to get someone who's already set in their ways that's going to cut corners.
Exactly.
So it's like hard for me to even allow somebody else to work with me. That's my biggest fear right now.
Right.
That's what keeps me up at night. When people say like, what keeps you up at night as a business owner? Not delivering the same level of customer service I did as the first day.
Yeah.
And hiring somebody who is not going to embody my same enthusiasm.
Yeah. Good movie to watch on that point, The Founder. That pretty much follows the same thing.
The it's Founder? Much,
yeah. It's the story of McDonald's and how it came. Because it was actually two brothers, but Ray Kroc, he actually went in and tried to franchise it and change all these things. So when he first started franchising it, he had, you know, some of his rich buddies in town and, you know, they started putting like fried chicken on the menu and all this type of stuff. They were like, because it sells. And like, I'm retired. I'm just trying to make money.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not what he wanted. So he found a way to actually get in. He was having money issues actually going to the bank because the way they set up the initial deal, he wasn't making that much money off of doing mm-hmm. franchises. So he went to the bank trying to, you know, make sure he kept his house because he put up his house for collateral. On his way out, one of the dudes said, hey, you're Ray Kroc, you own McDonald's, whatever. I think I can help you out because if you're not making money hand over fist, something's wrong. So he sits down with him and tells him he needs to get into real estate. So that way he can control the franchises. Just buy the land, tell him this is where you're going to set up your franchise at. If you don't follow, you know, my business model,
I'll kick you out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But the thing was, Ray Kroc was so focused on making money, he kind of lost sight of that mm-hmm. keeping that good product. And that's all the brothers really cared about because they tried to do franchises, but they was having that quality control issue.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a balance to figuring out what you want to do with your business. If you just want to care about the money, there's a way to do that. If you want to care about actual product, your customers, putting out quality, keeping what you built organic, there's a way to do that as well. So it's a give and take. So I understand that dichotomy.
Yeah, that's dope, man. Like, that's the type of stuff like I want to like watch and read about. And you know, it's, you know, I never thought I would be here this fast. So
definitely,
I felt like I would be here, but just not so fast, man. Like 7 months, it's just the way that it's moving is like the speed of lightning. But I mean, I'm built for it. The hardest part for me is giving my job the same energy and passion that I've given. So I don't really want to go to work anymore.
Yeah, I feel you. And, I go through that same I'm thing, not, man.
It's golden handcuffs because in my industry, you know, company car allowance and, you know, gas and everything paid for. That's like $1,500 a month that I get every month.
Yeah.
Wow.
You know, so it's like, you know, but I drive,
yeah,
you know, 100 to 200 miles a day.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's a lot where it's like golden handcuffs because you're getting this plush ass salary.
Right.
I get bonuses every quarter.
Wow.
So, like, you know, I make a lot of money, but it's not really a lot of money when you think about everything you do for this company.
Right. Right.
You know, if I took the same energy and time and put into my business, I can make what I make at work.
Right.
But I want to make what I make at work and add to this till I at least get debt free and maybe be to a point where I'm not solely dependent upon nobody's income but my own.
Yeah.
Right.
And then start another business. Like, I just want to, my goal for in the next 2 to 3 years is to walk away from corporate America and only start my own businesses.
That is a dream.
It's a dream.
That is a dream.
And it's it's a nightmare at the same time because it's a moment of fear.
Yeah.
Like, that security and that comfort goes away because you know you wake up every Friday or every other Friday, whenever you get paid, you know that money going to be in there.
Yeah.
It don't matter if somebody didn't buy your product the night before or somebody messed up an order and then you got to refund, you know, this order and try and figure out a way to get it back. That's the downside of, you know, being in the business. You got to be able to handle those situations.
Yeah, because it becomes, and that's why people are like, why you grind so hard? Like, man, you grind so hard. I'm preparing for that day when I walk away or the day when somebody come to me and say, you know, the wrong thing. And I just be like, I quit.
Yeah.
Or they say, well, we doing layoffs.
Word.
You know, it's time for us to let you go or you're not performing at the same level.
Right.
I'm prepared for that day when I'm just like able to just hang it up and just say, you know what? I don't know if I want to work another job or work for another company.
Man, that is, I think about it so often. Man. It's to the point now where I'm just like, fuck work. And I don't, I think I really like people. I'm a people person. I'm one of those people, like Donte will tell you, we'll go in a room and I find out three people. I find out context, what they do for a living. You know what I'm saying? Like, I like to connect with people. But my job is slowly sucking the soul.
It drains your energy. It drains your creative energy. It drains your drive to do what you got to do. So it's hard. And then the other thing I was going to mention, When you take that leap, be prepared for those downfalls and those setbacks. But be prepared to, you know, be late on your mortgage or your rent or something like that and figure it out. You might have to pay some extra because you're doing what you love, but you're putting your energy into something that's important to you and you building something. So it's gonna get rough at points when you take that initial step, but it'll work out in the end if you're really passionate about what you're doing.
Right. And that's where I'm at now, where I'm trying to downsize. Like from a fashion standpoint, I like really nice stuff. So, like, you know, for me, treating myself is $300-$500 pair of sneakers. Like, I don't buy Jordans and stuff like that. Right. I don't wear a whole bunch of sneakers. But when I do buy something, like, I want something foreign or something, you know, it's like, and that's a struggle too because, you know, it's like these companies don't really make the stuff for us. But I'm addicted to, you know,
Addicted to retail
and luxury and stuff like that. So it's like, you know, the Louis Vuitton belt that's $475.
God.
You know, the sneakers that's $550. Yeah. But I mean, it's a one time shot.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Exactly.
It's like,
you're not gonna pull them out every day.
You make six figures, you know what I mean? Every now and again you gotta treat yourself. But it's still like the whole conundrum of like you said, you don't pull them out every day. So it's like, man, you bought these sneakers and it's like they're just sitting there and it's like, you know, I mean, I went to the fight. The Gervonta Davis tank fight.
Wow.
Okay.
And we had floor seats and everything, and I was just joking with my buddy, like, man, I'm a...
This humble bragging.
No, right.
That's
like,
dope, though,
it was
man.
Cool, you know, it was like a gift, but I mean, I ended up paying for the seats and stuff, and, You know, I was like, I'm going to do something big. And yeah. I bought like this $500, $600, $700 leather jacket with like fur around a collar. And everybody was like, Frank Lucas. But it was like, yeah, right. It was dope. But part of that is it goes with the business where people are watching you. People are like checking your fly. So it's like, I was already fly before. And it's like, now I got to always be on my shit. So
it's the
like,
maintenance of the fly.
Right. So it's like, it's a maintenance of the fly all the way because people want to see that you're doing good and they gauge that by how you are.
Right.
So like right now I'm more like, I've been like peeling back from like getting shape ups. I used to be in a barbershop twice a week because of being in corporate America. I wanted everything to be crisp.
Yeah. Right.
Now I'm just like, man, I'm just letting my shit grow. Like I'm in the beer business and my shit be raggedy. Like, you know how the dude cut hair and you be like, you cut hair, your shit ain't never cut. Or the chick be like, oh, I'm a stylist, and she look like a bum every time you see it. You're like, you're lying.
But that's the physical appearance of you grinding. Mm-hmm. Like, you putting all your energy into what you're doing. You're not worried about yourself and your maintenance. You're worried about everybody else, making sure everybody else taken care of.
Right,
so.
And that's the facts to go along with it. But, you know, it's like kind of just settling in that place where I'm like, man, I got to get debt free. Like, you know, it's like I just want to get away from this debt so that if I do ever make a move, I could live freely. Because I could live off of, you know, making under six figures. But because of the lifestyle I created and, it's hard, you know, man. I mean.
Right.
A lot of stuff. Like,
at least you're honest with yourself, man.
Yeah, I mean, but some of it's not even like just from being like into like clothes and stuff like that. I mean, I went through a divorce last year.
Okay.
That pushed me into a lot of greatness with my business too. Because it's like, you're no longer with that person. You out on your own. And when you out on your own and you go through something like that, you start questioning a lot of things. Like, did I make the right move?
Yeah.
What did I do wrong? What could I have done different? And then it's the channeling part where you really find something that you're about to get behind.
Mm-hmm.
And you can't fail because you almost feel like that person watching you waiting for you to fail.
Word.
So it's like, my thing is like, you ain't never gonna fucking see me sweat. You ain't never gonna be like, yeah, he a loser now. Uh-huh, girl, I told you he wasn't shit. Fuck that. Like, if I gotta fucking stay up all night, like, it was times when, so I used to listen to Jay-Z, I Got the Keys. Like, that was my one song I listened to the whole time I was starting my business. It just happened to come out at the time when, like, June 29th, I started my business last year. I launched August 1st. And I was like, I'm trying to get this whole business started in a month. The dude was doing my website. Like, that's too fast. I'm like, just tell me, can you do it?
Right.
I don't really need you to tell me, like, what's aggressive or what's not. Can you fucking do it? Just do what the fuck I need you to do.
Yeah.
And, you know, talking to this person, like, how long is it going to take me to get back these combs? Or I can have it done in a week. Okay, cool. How long is it going to take me to get this for my product to be packaged and shipped? How long is it going to take me to do this? Okay, everything fits into my timeline.
Right.
That's what the fuck it's going to be.
Right.
So I would just come home, and I would just lay in my bed, and I just get out my notepad and just start doodling, like, naming barbershops that I wanted to be in. And ironically, like, most of the ones I named, not really carrying my stuff. But it's the people who I didn't know. Like,
that's
the funny thing. People who you don't know, they're the ones to call, like, yo, I want your stuff.
Right.
But it was, like, people who I thought was, like, oh, this person, I know that person. I wrote all this stuff down in a plan. But I would just have it playing. I got the keys. And he'd say, till you own your own, you can't be free. And I would just, like, play it back. And then it was, like, that joint was, like, every time I hear it, like, it's just, like, I go crazy because that was the motivation behind what I was doing. At 2 a.m, like, you falling asleep, and the next thing you know, you see your page running, and you slap yourself like, boy, you better get up and,
you
got to fucking grind. So it's like, you know, you got a deadline to meet, because sometimes it was me doing work after that.
Right.
So it'd be like, I'll put my work to 3 a.m.
Right.
after I did all my business stuff.
Yeah.
And now I'm like, I got to get this done by 5 a.m. because I got to work tomorrow.
Yeah.
And then now I'm in work trying to, like, stay woke, but...
Damn.
Yeah, but it's man, like,
that it's day, a beautiful grind though, man.
I can't wait till I'm able to talk to y'all, and it's like,
right. Well, are we gonna do an update?
We gotta do a podcast. I walked away.
Yeah,
like, you know,
it's nice to see people. So, just give some perspective. I remember Jason Bass from
Treason. Yeah.
So I remember when he had a line back at City of Gods. I used to have a line there too. And seeing what he's doing now, Steph wearing his stuff.
Right.
You see that video?
Yeah.
That's crazy, man. It's like, it's nice to see some, the progression. I mean, I remember
that feeling when the dude called me. It was like Terrence West and a couple of Ravens went and stuff. Like, so it was like, right. Like, I mean, it was like a month that I was in.
Right. Yeah. That's incredible, like, yeah, man.
Terrence West needs more stuff. And I like went down, like, met him off of White Lock. Like, we just down there rapping. And he's like, oh, yeah, Nick Mosby, my man, I got you. And it was like, yeah, I'm going to put this out. He's like, if you need, I'll bring you to the facility. It never happened, but
yeah,
that's just because he's busy. And
yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah.
You got to go through three.
You already know how that works.
But, I mean, it's one of those things where it's just a great feeling, like, to see, you know, like,
your hard work paying off.
Yeah, hard work paying off. And people like, yeah, a lot of stuff. Like, where can I get more? Like, how can I, like, oh, okay, cool. You know, sent a bunch of stuff to Quicksilver. Like, we grew up together in Northeast Baltimore.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Isn't he in D.C. now?
Yeah, he's in D.C. And, like, you know, he posted, like, yeah, you know, that type of stuff, like when you see that post come through,
right,
and,
you know,
like Quick is one of the biggest DJ, like one of the top four DJs in the world. Yeah. So it's like, you know, to
and a surprisingly good interviewer.
Yeah,
he's like incredible interviewer. Like,
Quick, I mean, hands down, like has grown so much. I mean, you know, to go from the DJ Planet Indigo 20 years ago when it was like a little hole in the wall, you know, LT come through,
right.
You know, knocking everybody out the way, beating people up. And it's like, you know, to go from that to where he is now, man, that grind right there.
Right.
Like, dude, like on his workout grind, I see the moves he making, like he taking care of himself fitness-wise, health-wise, business-wise, still the family, man. Like, those are the type of stories, like, I rally behind people from Baltimore who's making it. So,
right.
Yeah, shout out to Jason Bass and what he's doing and, you know, everybody doing something, because when, like I said, when I win, we win. When he wins, we win.
Exactly.
Somebody else is going to be like, oh, this is another company coming out of Baltimore. Cool. This guy reminds me of you. Now, let's put money behind him.
Right.
I ain't trying to take no venture capital deals, though. I ain't trying to have, I know I'm going to come in and buy me. Nah.
Right, right. Well, it's good. It's good that you have a plan on that, man.
Yeah, I don't want that. I did the meeting. I had Ray Lewis. I sat at the table with Ray Lewis.
Oh, wow.
Owner of Priceline.com, all these different venture capitalists.
Yeah.
And when I walked out of that meeting, I was like, I don't like the way it felt.
Right.
Like, I was like, you know, you're pitching your product to people and they're thinking like stuff that they could get behind.
Yeah.
And it's like,
And it warps your original.
Yeah.
Yeah,
your original
and it's like
vision.
You'll lose your creativity and your ability to be free. And I was like, yeah, I think I like the idea of being able to do what I'm doing right now to control every move.
Yes.
And not really feel like I got an answer to this person who gave me $1 million.
Word.
And then after I answer to them, you know, they still got some type of level of ownership of my product and my brand.
Yeah. Because the first thing they're going to say is, your product's incredible. It costs too much to make. You know what I'm saying? That's the first, because I'm from some personal experience, I know a couple people that are in the business, and that's the first thing that the venture capitalists say. They like, hey, This is incredible. It's too good. We got to cut this.
Yeah.
That was a big it's crazy,
man.
Just
artificial product in there to cut down the cost on it so we can double the match and we'll make much more money.
And a fun fact.
They doing stretching dope and
balls. Yeah,
yeah, exactly.
All these overdoses because everybody trying to put fentanyl in
it. And a fun fact. A fun fact about product, man. Aloe fact. If it says it has aloe in it, all it takes is a drop. Literally, something I found out.
To stretch it.
To when they say, you know, when they say with aloe or all that stuff, it could be a drop. It could be. It doesn't matter that. Yeah, it's with aloe. Yeah. So
but that's
like
anything. So this is another weird thing. So people are like, well, do you know how to make your product? Do you know everything that's in it? I know everything that's in it, but this is like your mother makes cakes, and she don't no longer use a recipe. She just whip it up. You could get the same recipe, but that don't mean you can make the cake the same way.
Very true.
Like,
exactly.
I'm not in the business. Like, people be trying to, like, literally find a way to tell me to, like, cut out the people who helped make me where I'm at. And I'm like, dude, like, you are sick because so many people, like, that's snake stuff. Like, I mean,
it is snake
stuff. I'm happy with the vendors and people I work with because it helps. I couldn't do what I do without them.
Right.
And I don't want to ever be in a position where, like, I cut them. Like, if we outgrow each other and the relationship outgrows itself and, you know, we can't do business because of that, cool.
Right.
But I don't never want to be like, yeah, I left them because they just couldn't keep up with me.
Mm-hmm.
Or I, you know, I didn't want to pay them no more. I didn't want to pay that person. Like, the best thing about being in business with a good product is you got to keep that same quality.
Right.
And people want that comeback. Like, they don't want to come get the same thing that they thought they was getting last month And it's like, nah, that's not the same sandwich. And it's because you decided that you're going to now become the chef instead of the marketer. Right. Now you want every penny,
right,
every dime to yourself. That's just crazy.
It is crazy.
Yeah.
But yeah, man. So we talked about a lot of heavy stuff, man. Let's get in the light end. Music. What are you currently listening to, man?
Oh, man. Like, I like the Migos.
That Culture.
I like,
man,
the Culture album.
That,
like,
Culture. The first four songs, the Migos, mm-hmm, I can listen to forever.
Yeah.
Then it gets kind of weird towards the end.
I don't really, you know, I never really like, I always like, sometimes when I get all the way down to the point where it's like slippery, sometimes,
yeah,
like I be, by that time I'm either out of the shower, almost dressed, and I never get to that part of the album.
Word.
Like, or I'm driving somewhere, I got ADHD, I get in the car and I want to listen to something,
right,
but I'm doing so much because like I'm trying to work two situations, so I'm like, yeah, calling places, yeah, for work, I'm doing stuff for Beer Butter, mm, I'm talking to, you know, like, esthetician that is like using my products in a barbershop somewhere,
mm,
or she's doing beard treatments. I'm doing something crazy, mm, and I don't get to the whole album. But the Migos, I tried to get into Plateau Plumber a little bit with Remy and Fat, yeah, Joe. Yeah. I downloaded it and I got in the gym, but it was like wasn't really gym work,
right?
So
right.
I got that off. My favorite single is the Beat the Odds and Remain Humble. Do numbers beat the odds?
That I ain't hear you. I didn't hear you.
Yeah, you heard that. Like,
I
got so used
from
to
what's
this.
What's the name? That's from a fucking.
Yeah, so like.
Crazy brain fart. Sorry about
that. Yeah, so that Future and Drake, like, yeah, that song is like my theme song right now. Yeah. Like, you know, Beat the Odds, Do Numbers and Remain Humble.
Mm.
That's like something like I can listen to every day.
Yeah.
Because it's like, you're like, you know, I had my back against the wall. Tell me why I don't deserve the ball. So that's what I'm thinking when I'm like,
yeah,
I deserve to go buy these sneakers. You know, like, I deserve to treat myself. Because for real, like, there's a lot of stuff that I went through. Like, I had some dark days where it's like, you know, I left the situation where I was married. And I, you know, got three little girls. And I had, like, 50% custody. And it was days when, like, it was Monday and I'm like, I got $6 till Friday.
Mm.
But I'm going to just get, you know, I'm going to just look in the refrigerator and we're going to make whatever happen.
Right.
Or I'm going to be good. You know, moms live right down the street. I'm going to be like, go over mom's house and fake like I ain't hungry. And she going to be like, baby, you want something to eat? And then I'm
yeah,
like, I'm good. And then I know I got the kids Wednesday. So I just got to feed them something Wednesday. Like, if I could get these three Lunchables and then I keep checking my account and make sure I don't overdraw. But then it's like, come Friday, we're going to hit a lick because we know 5,000 getting deposited. But then it's like, daycare dude, this dude.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just like, man, you know, when you go through a situation like that as a man, you don't never want to leave a situation and be like, well, I left you with all these bills.
Right.
So for me, it was like, nah, I'm going to pay this, I'm going to pay that, I'm going to pay that, da, 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 da.
Yeah.
Just because we ain't working out, I'm going to still make sure things good. But it's like, you're trying to put that all on your back, but you can't never sweat it like,
yeah,
I'm broke.
Yeah.
Just, I'm good.
Yeah.
I'm
yeah,
good. But it's like, better. So certain music that I hear, it hits me. Mm. And it's like, that's when I listen to this, like, I had my back against the wall. And it was like, I didn't know that I was going to be doing this. I didn't know I was going to start a business. Right. I didn't know what was going to happen. I mean, at one point, I was selling prescriptions for this pharmacy downtown on the side.
Mm.
And the dude fired me after, like, 6 weeks. Like, I ain't never been fired. Like,
right,
this motherfucker, like, who the fuck are you to fire me? Like,
right,
motherfucker, like, you're not working hard, daddy. And I'm like, motherfucker, you asked me to do some shit out of my room. Like,
right,
you hired me on the side. And he was like paying me, they're like, I'm gonna just get you $26,000 to work for me on the side.
Mm.
I'm like, shit, that's great on right, top of what I'm already making.
Right.
And then it was like 6 weeks into it, this motherfucker called me like the day before Easter. Like that Good Friday. It's Good Friday.
Right.
This motherfucker,
wow,
like, you're fired. I'm like,
it's cold, bro.
I need that money you were sending me
yeah,
up. But it's like, so all of this like combined get you that feeling. So the music, like, definitely, you know, like, but I still like my old stuff.
Yeah.
Like, I like just going back listening to old Jay, like American Gangster. Like, that's
I love
a favorite
American Gangster.
CD of mine.
Mine too.
I'm one of those people that I love Jay. That, for some reason, that album don't hit me like it.
American
it,
Gangster.
I used to play that shit every
I
day
because
I was
like,
still hooping at the time. So that would that
I'd appreciate
like,
my
soundtrack. Me and the homies steaming out back to back, beam, you know, thinking back to back, back in the Beamers out. It was
yeah,
our plans to go off to college, but the plans didn't even out to get a grant. You know, like, I can't even say the words right now, but it's like that whole
Dreamed
of you this morning.
Yeah, that's what it is to me. The samples that are on
there. The samples that are on there are so like old school, and then it's like that raw, like, for whatever reason, like, as much as I'm against selling drugs, that dope rap just does something for me.
Yo, Pusha.
It's like, Pusha.
Pusha and Jay?
So it's like, in that one song that they did recently, I can listen to that. I got, like, a good run playlist.
Okay.
So I got, like, a bunch of stuff that I listen to when I'm running. And I like singles. It's very rare for me to find a whole album I like at this point in my life. But I just snatch a single and throw it on my list. Throw it on my list. And then when I hear it, sometimes I'm like, why did I put that on it? And I just delete it.
Right.
Or it's like old stuff I take. But I mean, the mumble rap, I'm not into that. But man, I love some good Jay, Biggie. Yeah. I still love my Pop. Like, it's just some stuff that we from an era where we just so spoiled. Now, the shit that we getting fed is just like so watered down.
It's weird to see that. Man, and people have like real personalities.
Mm-hmm.
Like, Big had a personality.
Yeah.
Jay. You know what I'm saying?
But everybody, everybody carried it back then like they was true gangsters. Like, they had it like, you know, this is who I am. Like, even if you never thought Big was like the biggest drug dealer in Brooklyn, when he rapped, you felt it.
Yeah.
You know, same thing with Jay. When Jay came out, like, still spending money from 88, and it's 96, you like,
damn.
That's how you want to be. Like, you'll still hear people say now, like, man, I'm still spending money from 88. No, you was 9 when it was 88. Like,
right.
It's like, that's the mindset that you want to have, where it's like, you got money bundled up in shoeboxes under your bed because you just been stacking. Yeah. And that was that, like, what Jay-Z gave us. Like, he gave us that mentality, like, I was independent.
Yeah.
You know, I came out the trunk with my music. I ain't need nobody, no label to back me. I had my own money.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That's like, I love that talk, because that talk is the same thing I'm doing. I'm just not doing it, moving anything illegal, because I'm against that, tearing down our communities with that way. But for some people, that's how they made it. And it's like, now you learn from your mistakes and you move forward.
Yeah,
word. You talked about shoes quite often. What's your favorite shoes?
Oh man, like,
we gotta ask that two categories. the non-$300 and then the $300, because we gotta separate those.
Because
I don't mind hearing both. I would love to hear.
No, gonna say the shoes is what we do.
Yeah,
on the high end, you know the Saint Laurent, Saint Laurent, high top sneaker. It's a classic.
Is it comfortable?
It's comfortable.
Okay,
it's comfortable, but it's plain.
Okay.
Like, it's not anything crazy with it. Like, it's just a black leather sneaker, real simple. It's almost to the point where, like, if I got the right jeans on, they look like they dressed up.
Yeah,
you know, it's almost like they, you got on a good shoe. You know, you could go, like I said, you could be at a, you know, a nice little establishment where you almost look like, you know, with the right shirt or sweater on.
Mm-hmm.
You look like you dressed up a little bit. But then you could dress it all the way down where you got on, like, you know, the shorts and the sneakers and, hat to the back. And that's the versatility of it. But it's like, you know, it's a good high top leather, and it's different, where it don't really stick out like a sore thumb. Like, oh yeah, he got on some name brand high. Stuff be simple. Like these Margiela's I got on, like, they're just really simple. Like, they're not like crazy.
Right.
Like, they just, like, I had people ask me, like, oh, did you get them from Aldo? And it's like, no. But it's like, I'm cool with that, because it's like, I don't need. When I first started buying a designer sneakers, I wanted the Gucci, because it was like, oh, it's red, green. They know it's Gucci. They know I paid $600 for it. Like, you know, I still love my Gucci flip-flops that I had for like 8-9 years, because they are like my favorites in the summer to throw on with a pair of jeans But, you know, like, they classic. But, you know, just like, if I had to pick like a shoe or something, like, I love Butters. Like, I always love my Butters. Like,
that's such a good choice, man. Yeah, like, nobody's ever said that on the podcast.
Yo, for real, like, I love Butters. Like, a fresh, crispy pair of Butters just takes me back to high school.
Right.
When
are Timberlands for anybody that listens to this and have no idea what we talk about.
Yeah, the yellow construction boot.
Yeah.
We call them Butters because they look like butter.
Yeah.
And when they're nice and crispy, it's nothing like it. And it was a time in Baltimore when you could go to Total Mail and you could buy them for $99 a piece. And it was $120 at Nordstrom and for Locker everywhere else. But you go in Total Mail, I don't know how they pulled it off. But, you know, they were selling them $99 a pop. And we would go get 2 pair. And we wore Butters with shorts. And we had the guest jean shorts to come all the way down past our knee.
Right.
And we had the Polo Bigs that came all the way down to our knee as well. So it was like that was the wave, and that was what we did. But you know, it was fly.
Yeah.
And but now when the butters are back, like they just so classic. Like
it's a good looking shoe.
It's a great shoe, but sneaker. I like my all black Karachis.
Okay,
that's a good pick.
I like plain stuff. Like I either like something that's just like super cool, where you can do it all the time, or something that's just like super plain.
Yeah, because
I'm not like, I don't get to dress down as much, and then I'm simple. Like my girl, like, nah, you high end, you like expensive stuff, you know, you a diva, and I'm like, no, I don't really get to dress down that much.
Right.
So it's like when I do dress down, like I always envision myself like going somewhere. So it's like if I'm packing a bag, like I'm going to New York next weekend. So if I pack a bag, like I want to throw in a couple designer belts, a couple, you know, $200-$300 pair of jeans, you know, a couple, you know, high end shoes. Because it's like I'm only going out for the weekend, and that's the time when I really go out.
Right.
At that point, my friend is like, it's my birthday. You know, he's turning 37, and he's gonna be like, yo, let's get a table. You know, we're going to Afro Beats and Trap. Day party up in Brooklyn.
Oh, right.
And it's like, you know, we're gonna probably get a table, and it's like we're gonna spend $200 a piece. Like I feel like at that point moment, this is where we establish who we are as young dudes who are making it, because somebody is not gonna look at us and say, you guys are a lawyer, you are a business owner, and you are a pharmaceutical rep, and you're mayoral candidate or whatever. Like we're just gonna be in our element of who we are with our culture.
Yeah.
And at that moment, that's when we get to show our style and who we are and be unique. So it's like at that moment I do wanna throw something fly on and, you know, be in my element with the music knocking. And, you know, listening to that dope rap, because I'm like, yeah, you know, I'm spending it right now. It's like, spend the check and get it right. That's the mindset that you get in. Like,
I think that's what it is about that street rap. Like, you can apply it to whatever you're doing. It doesn't necessarily have to be selling drugs. You could be selling T-shirts, and you feel like, I'm
moving. But even when I was in high school, I mean, college, I wrote a marketing paper about Mon Diamond and USA Boutique, and how you walk in.
Oh, man.
So bad.
I haven't heard that.
Yeah, so USA Boutique, Christ. The way they made a lot of their money was they hired a lot of young girls.
Young,
attractive girls who like dope boys.
Ah.
So when you walked in, they had the little young, hot bodies. They had no clothes on. And the music is knocking, like, it's straight.
Yeah,
like,
right.
You know, that hustle rap, and it's like, spend the check, and it's bouncing in your head subconsciously. Right, it's like that. Right. But to go along with the music telling you to ball till you fall, and don't worry about no bills, spend your last, is this chick like, you should get that. It look cute on you. I like that on you. And you like
that with this.
You like this. I think red looks good on you. And you're so dumb and naive.
Right.
You like, shorty, it's nothing.
Right.
And you go pay for it. And then you ain't walk even out and you're like, why about a polo shirt for $90?
Right.
Because it was the way that they marketed it to you. And it works.
Get this iceberg sweater with Donald Duck on the front.
$350.
$400. Make you feel...
Spent my refund check on an iceberg t-shirt.
Yo, I love iceberg. I still love ice. I think they should... Somebody should bring them back for a little bit.
Iceberg Slim, big.
Possible. I love iceberg.
Possible.
Yeah.
What else? So we was on sneakers.
Sneakers. Yeah. All right. So... My brain is mush right now, but we have a portion of the show that we connect to it called the Branded 10, right? Mm-hmm. So we get every guest, as soon as possible, to make a 10-song playlist on Spotify that kind of represents who you are. So, you know, when you're done with the podcast, think about some stuff you want to add, and then send us your list.
Whatever your soundtrack to your life is.
Yeah.
That's dope.
And we'll post it. We'll post it with the podcast. We'll include it in the body of it. Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah. I'm glad it's connected, man, because, like, it's I've gotten some good compliments on, because people don't expect some of the songs.
Yeah. And it gives you a different insight to who these people are.
Right.
Yeah,
you can tell a lot about a person by what music they listen to.
Mm-hmm.
It's very true.
I mean, I've just gotten so far away from music, TV, and everything. Like, I tell you honestly, like, in the last year, I've watched my TV maybe 10 times. I haven't played my gaming system. I used to play Madden for 8 hours a day.
Yeah.
Like, I literally, like, used to come home from work and just play Madden for, like, 6 to 8 hours.
Mm.
Like, my friends, like, we had a community. So, I mean, it was literally like 20 of us.
Right.
And we had text messages that come in. They don't even send me the messages no more. I used to be in the group. Nobody, nobody hits me because they we were dedicated to it. I mean, it was to the point where I was missing work to play PlayStation.
Wow.
You know, the game came out. We did the Midnight Madness. We was...
Yeah,
it was a couple times. It's a culture. You know what I mean?
Yeah, definitely.
And it's like we would be into it. And the thing was, like, a lot of those guys don't go out. They don't club. They don't party.
Right.
So it was like I come in 2 in the morning drunk, pick up the sticks, click the little button, and 8 people were on the mic. You know, it's like I'm waiting for one person to drop out the room so I could get in the room and find the challenger. And I play from 2 to 5 drunk.
Yeah.
You know, wake up, still got my clothes on. You know what I mean? Like a bag of chips on the floor. Like, and but that was what we did. But I thought that was something I loved until I got out of my situation where it was just something that was holding my time and attention. Yeah. And now that I'm putting my time and attention in here, I don't love watching TV as much as I thought I did.
Right.
I don't miss watching Black Ink and all that stuff that I used to do because it was passing time.
So funny you say that because I'm definitely gonna watch that after this. I got the 2.
I want to see the rest of the Khalif Browder story.
I haven't
watched it. So the second episode came on last night. That's something that I started checking out.
So did the Jay discussion come on last night or the second part of it? Because like they had a
second part to my knowledge.
Because there's a I downloaded one of the parts and there's a discussion with Jay-Z talking about.
You put that up?
Yeah.
All right.
It's episode 0. It's weird. It's like I think it's like an in between joint. Yeah. And then they're gonna put up the
All right.
Yes, I did. I did put it up.
All right.
Yeah.
I definitely wanna check that out. But
there's
a lot of things that you think are things that you love and you wanna do.
Right.
But when you get busy, like the real kind of busy.
Yes.
Nah.
Real busy.
You don't even think about it.
Yeah.
And that's the difference with I've been fake busy before, and I got friends who are fake busy. I hate fake busy because it's like we planning a trip to go to Vegas, and I just want to let you know that, like, yo, I just need the rest of your deposit today.
Yeah.
Or, hey, because we going to Vegas in May, and it's like January, we can get this flight and everything if we just lock it in.
Right.
I got my, you know, I got my my travel agent ready to knock this down because it's 4 of us instead of me just booking it straight up. Like, I'm taking one for y'all. I'm going to book.
Yeah.
Everybody put down 150 and we good.
Right.
You locked in, you pay when you want. Motherfucker, you can't answer the phone. Like, it's 8 hours later and you're like, I was busy.
Yeah.
You seen it, I called you. Like, you're not that busy because I seen you like a post.
Right.
Under Delicious or you like Ashanti new picture, like, stuff like that where you'd be like, come on,
yeah,
it took 5 minutes away to do something. Like, all I asked is that you answer my text. I text you, this is important, call me back.
Yeah.
Or, hey, we need your deposit. I need your credit card. But, yeah, so
fake
it's like.
Fake busy is the worst.
Yeah,
right.
So.
Fake busy is the worst.
Oh, man, but.
Yeah, that's dope, man.
It's good to be busy.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, definitely.
It's really a blessing.
Definitely.
It really is.
Some people complain about it, but it's a good thing to be busy because you're doing something.
It is.
Mm-hmm.
I'd rather be doing something than doing nothing.
Yeah, true.
Definitely. Well, anything else? I think we covered a ton of shit.
Yeah. I did forget before we started. iHeartRadio. We're officially on iHeartRadio now, so you can listen to The Breakfast Club, and then you can listen to us afterwards. Just search for the podcast, brand it. You can listen to it, whatever. It's on demand on there now. Then the other thing, I appreciate everybody that's been tuning in, listening. Last month was our best month yet, so numbers are going up for the podcast, so that's good.
Keep telling
your friends, keep sharing it, posting it. Engaging with it, emailing the podcast, branded at debonairmaterial.com. Follow the brand Debonair Material on Instagram, Deb Material on Twitter, fan page. We have a branded one, so BRNDD podcast on Facebook, as well as Debonair Material on Facebook.
Yeah. Oh, shout out to Kalila Wright from Mess in a Bottle. She was on a TV show pitching her brand to Mark Cuban and shit. I'm like, man, she was a architect at Under Armour, quit her job to start this business, Mess in a Bottle, just empowering messages.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that she puts, like, t-shirts that she puts in a bottle and sends it out, and it's doing really well, man. So
nice.
Congratulations to Kalila. Yeah. It's pretty incredible.
Yeah, I'm on social media as well. So yeah, man. Where can they find you at? Yeah, Creative Culture Lifestyle. CreativeCultureLifestyle.com. Creative Culture Lifestyle on Facebook. And for Twitter, CCL Beard Butter.
Okay.
At CCL Beard Butter.
And what products can they get on the website?
So we have everything. I mean, we got the dad hats and snapbacks. We got the beard butter, the soap, the shampoo. Everything's all natural. We have the beard packages where you can, you know, choose a comb, brush, or a wood pick. All products that are going to be good for your beard. Three beard butters, three different scents, or you could do one scent, whatever it is that you want. And then combine that with a shampoo and a soap, all for $50. And then we turn around and, you know, I do a beard bag, which is now a new toiletry bag called the Dop Kit. You know, that bag is available, and that's like a great piece because it's like every man needs a good travel bag. And a lot of the toiletry bags that come with your suitcase, kind of corny. But like if you ever like traveling to go over your girl house overnight or whatever, this is the bag in your bathroom that you hang on the door. Or you just grab it and throw in like a few condoms. You throw in a toothbrush. You know, I call it like the beard bag, a.k.a. the thought bag, a.k.a. the cigar bag. Whatever you want to use it for, it's just that like little handheld bag. It's not like a man purse or nothing like that. It's something you wouldn't carry around just like walking around in stores. But like if you want to throw a few things in it, you know, it's a good sturdy bag. It's got the pockets. And then like we come back to the specialized combs. You know, all the combs, $15. The wooden pick is $20. It's a heavier piece. But, you know, we're on Amazon, free shipping on Amazon at all times. It's kind of built into my price, though. And then, you know, Amazon's a little bit different because they want that piece of everything I do.
Right,
don't be surprised if the stuff on Amazon is a little bit more expensive because I got to make up for that difference. But, you know, we're on Amazon, man. It's a lot of different hats. Like, I got, like, 10 different hats. I got, you know, wood lapel pins. I got, you know, some buttons that I'm about to make. I got this Made in Baltimore hat coming. Just keep checking us. Like, we going to be here. And that's the beauty of having an online business. I have no overhead. So I'm making money even when I'm not doing anything. I look at it like if I work 2 hours a day and I made $200 a day, I made $100 an hour. If I work 2 hours a day and I made $20, I made $10 an hour a day. But the goal is that, you know, you keep running the ads on Facebook, you keep running the ads on Instagram, and you touching 10, 15,000 people off of a $100 ad for 7 days. Like, you can't beat that. And it's like, I mean, I've had orders all week from all of the markets that I targeted in my advertising. So to get orders from South Carolina, Atlanta, you know, Philly, New York, Harrisburg, all these different places that I've been targeting, it's just great because it's like, that just keeps the business rolling. And then turn around and have the big wholesale deals. You know, you never make as much money off the wholesale as you do the full product. But you're putting the product in different people's hands. People can now access you. Everybody don't want to order online. Cool. I'm going to get it either way.
And the thing is, like, putting those products in those other stores, something that you put in that store, they might not be able to get in the store because they like that initial product that you did put in the store. They're going to come directly to you to get what they can't get. So it comes back to you.
And then the store's going to mark up too. It's like, I mean, at the end of the day, you're not beating shipping because people were like, I don't want to pay shipping. I run free shipping all the time. Like, I've been running free shipping for 9 days. And I mean, it's paying off really great. But, you know, people just like, it's the silliest things. Like, if people abandon carts, I'm that guy who will send you an email like, hey, you abandoned the cart. You know, like, my program gives me all of that. I'm look at all of them numbers like, oh, yeah, you was about to spend how much? Why are you dumping all these hats in the cart and you ain't buying them? Like, we need to talk about this. You know, so, man.
Then that's the funny part, too. Like, when you run free shipping, they'll double or triple their initial order. Like, they would have just got one hat with the regular shipping, but now it's free shipping. They're going to order a whole bunch of stuff.
And it don't make that big of a difference. Like, you know, the matter, like, I look at it as either under 13 ounces, it's going to be $2 to $3. Over 13 ounces, we looking at $5, $6
That's nothing.
So like
that's your little chicken box that you go to the corner and
get. They don't think about it like that. They don't want to pay no shipping. And that's the thing with Amazon. A lot of people on Amazon are there because they get free shipping.
Prime
members and stuff like that. But I just can't. I haven't gotten to the point where I ship all my stuff to Amazon. So that Prime members get that stuff free. So I just get free shipping for my products. But The shipping everything to Amazon is like, if I ship it to you and I ship all the stuff to you, then I got paid to ship it to you. Then I got paid to ship it to you again. Yeah. You're already getting a piece of my pie. Like, damn, you got your hand all the way up my skirt. Like, right. Damn, it's a lot. Like, damn, B, you like trying to finger him? Get your hand. Get out of here, man. Get out of here. So it's like, come on, man. Get your hand on my pocket.
You're right. Malcolm X.
But shout out to Amazon. We appreciate you. I love you, baby.
Always good business, man. Because I've dealt with Amazon, too, and the people that reached out to me from there, they're actually really good people. One of them actually bought one of my products. So, you know, it's a good company. There are some you know, challenges dealing with, obviously, another company. But that's always going to be a case when you building your business. So,
right. I got one question for y'all, and then we can be done.
What's up?
Tell me, like, just off the top of your head, when you first looked at my business, what was it that you seen as far as, like, what was your impression? Like, whether you just went to the page 5 minutes before I walked in, or you went to the page 3 months ago.
Yeah.
Like, just give me that feedback. Like, I'm always looking to get better. So I want to know, like, what people's perception is. Not even like, oh, you can improve on this. Or just what was your first impression? Like, is this interesting? Or is it like, oh, yeah, it's another beer butter. Or what were your thoughts?
Well, the first thing, so I looked at it second. He told me about it because he was interested. And I thought it was dope because I don't know, man. Like, I like seeing black people doing good versions of things. Yeah. I love good versions of things. Yeah. I will always support good versions of things. And it just presented it in a way that felt like something I would want to purchase. You know what I'm saying? I'm broke right now. I get paid on the 15th. But then when I get paid on the 15th, I'm probably going to buy something. You know what I'm saying? Like,
I appreciate
that. That's a good feeling when you see something, especially locally.
Right.
It's, you know what I mean? And I could tell people about it because I know a lot of bearded people.
Yeah. And that's the goal.
Yeah.
And then, like, for me, like,
we met in person.
Right. Yeah, and so that was the thing, like, seeing the actual product. And I've started making that push towards natural products and finding things to actually take care of my body and, you know, get away from the artificial things, those GMOs and all that. Like, taking care of my body on inside and out. So knowing that I can find a natural product that's made for black people that I can get locally, that I can have a conversation with the owner. Mm-hmm. Like, that's important to me because I go to trade shows and stuff. So I do clothing. Like, that's how my business started. It turned into a lifestyle brand from the other things that I've been doing. But initially started with clothing. So I go to trade shows, and certain trade shows, they'll be more expanded just outside of clothes. So it'll be companies that carry, you know, facial products or bearded products and stuff like that, but it's not black products. It's not products for us,
right?
Because we have different needs, and seeing a product that caters to us, that was important to me. So I felt that dope.
No, I appreciate that, man. And that's like when we met. I mean, I remember, like, I'll never forget those days when I first started and I do a pop-up shop and I'm like, I'm here for 4 hours.
Yeah.
And I walk out and I sold like $30 worth of stuff.
Yeah.
But it's like, the conversations I had with him were so much more bigger than the dollar amount. And that's what I will always tell myself. A lot of things I will do are for the look. And I tell people, sometimes you got to do it for the look.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And the look might be, you know, you hosting this brunch or you doing this or doing that. It's not the people that were there. It's to the people that's on the outside looking
in. Yep.
So people are like, wow, he did that. You know, wow, like, he did this big party. Could be three people there. They don't know.
Right.
But to the people that's on looking and watching your business and watch what you do, that's why you got to always do your marketing up here. Because it's like people, and I'm holding my hands up high, people. Like, people are always looking to see, like, where you're projecting yourself.
Right.
If you project yourself down low and, you know, you dumb down every idea and everything that you have, you're going to lose out. But sometimes you got to be willing to take a big risk. And it, you get there and you do something and it don't pan out to how you wanted it, but the feedback, people who weren't there, like, yeah, I see you doing big things, man.
Right.
Like, I see you popping up, you pulling up in parking lots, popping your trunk up. And I'm like, that's not really what a pop-up shop is. Like, I'm not really just sitting down at with my trunk open, but
selling bootleg DVDs.
Yeah,
so it's like, people come up to you that you're not even thinking about or looking at your movement.
Yeah.
But they are. And people are watching. It's a lot of people on social media that just watch.
Mm-hmm.
You get 100 likes, but 1,000 people seeing everything that you did.
Yeah.
And that's the beauty of it. So if anybody out there is listening and they want to start their own brand, start their own business, be strategic. build a story, tell a story.
That's what's important.
Like, don't just go willy-nilly on social media trying to post stuff to get likes or to get money. Build the story so that when I come back and I start following your movement, I really follow a movement and not just you throwing stuff out there.
Yeah.
Blog. Like, if you want to be something, start blogging about it. Build a category. You know, start a club. You want to make t-shirts, start a t-shirt club.
Yeah.
You know, create your own following, your own category. Just do it creatively. Like, you know, just come at it your way. Build an audience. Build me an audience. That's what I always say every time I get on live. When you get on Facebook Live, it says, we're building your audience. And I say, build me an audience. Because it's people who are going to listen and tune in and want to hear what you say.
Right.
And then find a way to give back. Like the piece where I'm doing a nonprofit, that means so much to me because I feel like I got to give back. I was just coming out of Chick-fil-A, and a guy was like, well, I was walking in, and he like, oh, give me, you got some money? And I'm like, I'll buy you some food. So I bought him a chicken sandwich, and another dude was like, if you give me a Coke, that's cool, but if you don't, I'm still good. And I wanted to buy him the Coke more than anything because he took the approach that like, yo, you ain't got to do nothing for me, but if you can, since you're buying homeboy a sandwich, like, hook me up with a Coke. And I was like, cool.
Right.
And I came out, gave him their food, and I got in my car. And the dude at Chick-fil-A was like, you a good dude for doing this. And I'm like, nah, man, it's like it's about giving back.
Right,
like,
right.
I haven't always been the best person in my life, but, you know, I'm blessed.
Right.
And I'm going to always find a way to impart something to somebody else. And that's my biggest takeaways.
That's dope.
Definitely, man.
Well, we appreciate you coming through, man.
Yeah, man. Definitely. It's been a great conversation. A lot more enlightening than I expected.
We got to go get a beer or something one day.
Yeah, like, definitely.
I don't drink, but I'd get some water, some pineapple juice. I'll definitely go.
We kick it another time.
Yeah, I was going to say, you know, a liquor company. I know a couple. We can, you know, reach out to them. Might be able to do something, but yeah, man.
We'll keep people updated about your journey, man. And we want to have you back on. Look, if you did this much in 7 months, what you gonna do in six? You know, seven more. You know what I mean?
I'm nervous, man, because it's like I'm energetic. Like I'm excited. So many things to come still, like that haven't even really come to fruition yet. But it's growing, it's building, and I'm ready for it.
I feel the same way, man. Because it's been 6 months since we started the podcast, and we already getting invites to do live speaking events and stuff like that, and like
get some product offers and stuff like that.
Yeah,
but it's cool, man. And it's just the beginning. You know what I'm saying? And I'm not looking for any reward in it right now beyond telling these stories, man.
Because
people literally do not have any stories about anybody on the ground that's talking about how they started on the ground level and working their way up.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's hard to find that. Yeah. You find these clips, you see people living the life now, but hearing your story and your...
I'm still at the bottom, man.
But nah, it's
no, it's like it's good. Like, I love it. Like, this is the best part about it. Like,
right.
I'm scared of the days when I get so big that I'm not running my day to day. I want to always be connected. I have my contact number listed for when people go to my Instagram, and I like when they call me. I hate when people email or text, and I'm like, just call me, because the questions you have, I can answer by telling you. And if you're growing a beard, stop focusing on growth and just focus on having a product that's keeping your hair healthy.
Right, right.
Keeping your beard healthy. Every man wants to know, like, is it going to make it grow? No! Like, beards grow differently based off of genetics.
Right.
You know, how high it's going to grow on your cheek, or, you know, how low down on your chin underneath or whatever. It grows differently because it's all based on, like, your father's beard, his father's beard, your mother's father, you know, all of these different things combined give you your beard, like testosterone levels, like different stuff. Like, some people just hairy, some people not. And then people are like, I want this big, massive beard. And it's like, I guess maybe they never met their dad, so they don't know what his dad's beard looks like. I'm an asshole sometimes.
It's good to dream, though. Can't kill everybody's dream, man.
Right. Yeah, my man over here. He's trying to grow it out.
Yeah, I was great. I didn't even tell you about that. So initially when I hit him up to come on, he was like, yeah, man, you know, I can bring some products through. And you mean, do any of y'all have a beard? Well, I was like, well, Ron has a beard. You know, I'm actually still working on mine. You know, it's coming in though. He was like, well, yeah, you know, you can go ahead and put it on your goatee or whatever.
But there's a lot of things you can do, man.
Hit the little bottom.
You know what I mean? Hit the mustache or whatever.
Some things you can do to grow your beard organically.
Yeah.
You got to listen to that one podcast. I was wanting to talk about that.
Okay. I got it. Oh, yeah. Tell us about that podcast.
Yeah. What's the name of that podcast?
The Boonie Breakdown. So, a good friend of mine, Boonie, she used to have this thing called Boonie 84 Ratchet Hour on Twitter.
Mm.
That was her name on Twitter, at Boonie 84. And, you know, we used to do this wild, not podcast, because it was just an hour of just ratchetness.
Right.
And it would be like people would DM. They wouldn't come out and say.
Yeah.
So a chick would be like, yeah, I slept with two guys. It wasn't all I thought it was going to be. It was a little wild, but, you know, it wasn't fun. You know, the one dude wasn't into it because, you know, the dude accidentally touched him. Whatever, just like crazy stuff.
Right.
Just crazy stuff. But then it's like we were talking about the last time we did this podcast. We were talking about business. We were talking about having sex. We were talking about crazy stuff you did during sex. She was talking about the dude that was cracking an egg on a chick head while he
Brian Pumper. Hero. That was Brian Pumper.
Okay. So
there was unsung hero.
Right. So Brian, that was like something he was doing. Then I was talking about like this one crazy thing I did one time. Like I was having sex with this chick. So it was just like a lot of stuff we talked about on that was like really crazy. And like when I did that podcast, I didn't even want to talk about my business, so the two wouldn't even be associated. Yeah,
right.
Because it was just so like it was just. But that's the fun thing about her. Like she did her last podcast with like a couple girlfriends, and they were just talking about like how women like sex too, and women already know if they're gonna give you sex, and then if like they have sex with a guy, and then he like messed them over, they need to go away for like a couple months. And then they come back and pray that they don't have bad sex with the next guy. So it was like a lot of stuff that, you know, sometimes, you know, we don't think about that much.
But those type of things, it's also important to have open conversation about as well, because that's how you learn.
We living in a sexual society. Like, if you can't talk about sex and that makes you uncomfortable, like, get over yourself. Like, you know, it makes me think that you probably, like, a pedophile, or you're like,
you're doing
in
something
in the dark, doing some crazy stuff to yourself, beating yourself with a whip. But I mean, we're adults, like we're in our 30s, you know, we're older, you know, now we're able to talk about sexuality, we're able to look at our mate and say, baby, if you do this a little different, that'll help.
The worst thing
is being with somebody for a whole period of time and you find out all this time you've been doing something wrong.
That's where that conversation comes in. And if you don't talk about it, you're just going to keep doing what you're doing, thinking it's working.
Exactly.
And she don't like that shit at all.
Right.
So,
just about to start open dialogue. Podcast.
Right. But yeah, we appreciate you coming through, man. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Appreciate it.
Yeah. Again, appreciate everybody listening. Please leave comments. I see y'all listening, y'all liking, more people listening. Those comments help us out. Let us know what we're doing good, what you like, what you don't like. The comments help our ratings on iTunes, all that. If this is your first time listening, you can find us on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, SoundCloud, iHeartRadio, iHeartRadio, TuneIn, pretty much everywhere you listen to podcasts.
You have no SoundCloud excuse at this too. Point.
Like I said before, debonairmaterial.com. All the episodes are there. Deb Material on Twitter, Debonair Material on all the other platforms. Ron, where can they reach you?
Who is Ron James?
All right.
That's me.
Everywhere, right?
Everywhere.
Everywhere.
Everywhere. I don't know why I said it like that.
Yeah, so.
Unforgivable.
Branded Conversations with Creatives. My man Brian from Creative Culture. Appreciate you coming on, man.
Thanks. Appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah. We out.